The Axis of Evil. You've heard about it, but until now, you've only heard half the story. Now, you can experience the softer side of evil when you join the Axis of Evil Fan Club. Not that kind of club, Sodom.
Oh, sorry!
The Axis of Evil Fan Club has already been approved by the entire population of France. And when you join, we'll send you an autographed 8x10 glossy of one of the evil but lovably wacky nutjobs who runs Iran.
Dear infidel, best wishes for an untimely death you so very much deserve. Regards, your loving mullah.
Plus, when you join the Axis of Evil fan club, the dog-eating evildoers of North Korea will include a beautiful Axis of Evil t-shirt with this peace-loving message.
Check it out. It says, I joined the Axis of Evil fan club, and all I got was this lousy t-shirt, so therefore I deserve to die. Whoa, that's so cool.
And best of all, joining is easy. Send no money. Just keep questioning the wisdom of naming names in the war on terrorism, and you're a member of the Axis of Evil fan club. Join today.
Okay, all the schmata heads all the time, all the getchkis all the time, all the people with their 8th century garb, man. It just, you know, it's the 21st freaking century. Get with the program. Get with the pogrom. More good news from Iraq, by the way.
Well, good.
Iraq's sectarian warfare fueled a sharp increase in global terrorism in 2006. The U.S. State Department reported yesterday the total number of terrorist attacks was up more than 25%.
Oh, my God.
From the previous year, according to the State Department's annual report on global terrorism. Incidents in Iraq accounted for nearly half of the 14,000 attacks. And keep in mind that before we went in there and raided the country and overthrew Sodom and occupied it, they didn't have any of that. But we're doing a wonderful thing for them peoples. Incidents in Iraq accounted for nearly half of the 14,000 attacks and about two-thirds of the more than 20,000 fatalities worldwide. The number of deaths blamed on the attacks increased by about 40, not...
About 30, man.
No, about 40%. Wow. More good news. Every day the news gets better and better. Is it me or is it, I don't know, the overhead? I guess I could crank it up a little bit.
Sounds fine.
Does it sound fine?
Yes.
Does it sound like me?
Just like you.
No, well, that's
fine. Or someone that sounds just like you.
Oh, we're fine.
Here's the poll from yesterday, and I don't know, just they really don't care. Like I said, there's no passion for much of anything in South Florida except the early bird dinner, because South Florida is basically...
Crap.
Yeah. I hate to put that... Yeah, I mean, there's some nice people there, you know, here and there. You got to search, but there's some nice folks, but they're stuck there, basically, I think. How pissed off are you that the Dolphins didn't draft Brady Quinn? 1,531 votes. Oh, don't let me forget to do some homework on the Kentucky Derby.
Okay.
I don't have any idea who's running. I don't know anything about any of these horses. I guess I better go online and start doing my studying.
Your due diligence?
My due diligence for Friday's show, because I don't want Dave Johnson to call in and have me say, who's running, Dave? You like that? That would be really...
Yeah, like I do.
And then you pick a name out of a hat. That's a good way to do it anyway. Here comes the bunny, and there goes your money. A fool and his money are soon parted, baby. All this gambling stuff is for crazy people. That's why tomorrow's an early Woodbine Wednesday. We get out of here at 12:30 tomorrow.
Oh!
Not that we're excited about that.
But we are.
But we are. At least I don't lie about it. I'm not going to say, oh, gee, we're getting screwed. Who cares? The money continues coming in. And speaking of that, we got the ratings coming out on Friday. Is there going to be any bonus money for anybody?
No.
Confidence isn't just low. Confidence doesn't exist in this particular situation.
Well, you know, very low.
We've had kind of a rough run here for a couple of months at QAM. We made a little bit of a comeback in the last month there, in the last trend, but I don't think enough to get us any money, which you desperately need.
Yeah.
How about Chris? Do you get a bonus? What are you
laughing
about?
Yeah, I think that's called my paycheck. That's about it.
Why are you laughing so hysterically? I don't
nobody
know
else. Nobody gets bonuses.
You and I do.
That's it.
And that's it?
That's the list.
Not Josh Cordes, because he used to work on the show. He never cashed that check, by the way. I don't care what Chris keeps telling me. He never cashed it.
Maybe he doesn't want it.
Maybe he wants to send it back. That would be okay. In fact, that $1,200 I sent him, that would come in handy tomorrow at Woodbine. I could lose that in the first 45 minutes. In fact, if I want to play the $5 machine, I could lose that, I'd say in like 10 minutes, easy. How pissed off are you that the Dolphins didn't draft Brady Quinn, the Mighty Quinn? Now, do you have that by Manfred Mann, Mighty Quinn?
I think I do. Let me...
Oh, that would be look so sweet to hear that. That would be sweet. Not as sweet as Brady Quinn. They don't come no sweeter than that.
Whoa, what's that?
That's not it. What is that?
I don't know. It sounded like Sarah Evans.
Here we go. This sounds more like the Mighty Quinn to this old queen. The Mighty Queen.
Come over in. You'll not see nothing like the Mighty Queen.
Oh, yeah.
That enough?
He's the best, Brady. Mm-mm. Roll over, Brady. 1,500, like a dog, 1,531 votes. Don't care that the Dolphins didn't draft it. Don't care. 560, 36.5%. Roll back over now. Not surprised they suck, meaning the Dolphin organization. That's the audience saying that now. Not us, of course. 446. I'm happy he blows, 176. Brady Quinn blows. I agree with their choice, 173. Who wants him anyway from Notre Dame Dame? Psychotic, 109. There are 109 people psychotic because the Dolphins didn't draft Brady Quinn. And ready to blow my brains out, 67. And we'll help you out. We'll send you a piece. We'll send you the peace pipe and you can smoke it. George will come over and you guys can smoke it together. There you go. Okay, let's take a look at today's poll. This is too much like old times now. This is the way we used to do it. Although, you know, not that it makes a difference. Not that, well, although, let's take a look at that schedule today. See if we have anything exciting going on. The Humper is already in Louisville? Wow, boy, he sure has a tough assignment all the time. And I see he's not on tomorrow, and he's not on Thursday, and he's not on Friday. Although he is on, now, according to the schedule, today and Friday, he's on the Power Hour with the Mad Dog. According to the schedule. Do we believe the schedule necessarily? Oh, Clarence, don't make no mistakes. So we got Mad Dog at 2, Power Hour with Mad Dog and Hank at 4, Hank in Louisville for the Derby at 5 this afternoon. He'll be on the air briefly. 6:35, it's Marlins on deck. How'd the Marlins do last night, by the way, Chris?
They won 9-6.
All right. See, pretend you care. Do we care? No. Especially we don't care because they're a lame duck anyway. They're not going to be on the station next year anyway, so hub them and dreer it. Marlins at the Mets again at 7:05 tonight to see if they can repeat the great success they had last night. And and by the way, did Ottawa really beat New Jersey 2-0 last night, or did I dream that? Wow! And Game Night with Eddie Cave follows the Marlin game tonight till about 1 a.m. till Eddie falls asleep. Okay, here's today's poll. There's Lou Dobbs. The war on the middle class and those damn illegal aliens. And what are we going to do about the Mexicans? And let's shoot some beaners and stuff like that. Poor Lou Dobbs, man. He lost it once upon a time in America. He lost it. He's a crazy person now. I'm not saying I disagree with everything he says, but he's a crazy person. Lou Dobbs, pompous ass. Does that come to, when you see him, does that come to mind, pompous ass?
Okay.
817 votes on a very marginal poll today. This is one of Charlie B's, I guess. And Charlie's got 600 polls in my pile here, including a really good one for tomorrow. But this one today, I don't know. Do you think this is a good poll? I think it blows. An estimated 900,000 Floridians drive our roads with suspended licenses. Your response, question mark? I think this poll blows. Confiscate their vehicles, 192. Throw their asses in jail, 171. What you expect from third world drivers, 150. That sounds like some kind of an ethnic shot to me. You know what I mean, Charlie? Sounds ethnic. I could be wrong.
Nevertheless, it's a little
it
true.
Is. But. It is true. I bet most of them are here in South Florida, 123. That's true. Just shoot them, 80.
Shoot them in the leg.
Or wherever, you know, if you're a bad aim, that's okay, too. I'm one of them, 38. Revoked their licenses permanently. Let me try it again. Revoked their licenses permanently, 32. And fine them and slap them on the wrist, 31, which is almost as fun as...
Shoot them in the leg.
I like that better. 817. 825. Little chunk just came in there. Wow. Chris is all whipped up about that because he gets paid by the vote. Now, wouldn't you like that if you got paid...
Oh, I would love that.
A dollar a vote? You may already have 825 banks in the till for today. You could go to Vegas.
Exactly.
If you were making those kind of bucks. And then you'd... Then you'd see this guy get real interested in the daily tally on the vote totals. Then all of a sudden, it would really change your tune. You'd be singing a whole different... Come on, let's get up to 1,500 a day, folks. You can do it. Come on, old man.
What are you talking about? I'd be pushing for 3,000 votes.
I got news for you, man. You're pushing your luck right now, okay? Now, you're all right. You know Josh. That's what that one queen says that calls in every day and wants Josh's body.
Mm-hmm.
And for that reason, I'm glad.
You don't want to be my little boy, huh? Where did you come up with that stupid? What was that all about?
My little spur boy. Of the moment kind of a
exactly.
Kind of.
Sperm of the moment. That was so bad.
Ooh.
My little boy. That is so, ooh.
Yeah, love monkey sounds way neat.
I feel unclean when you say that. If you said that about the Serbian stallion, I'd say, all right. You know, but Josh Cordes.
Well, you're the one that put your tongue down his throat in the elevator.
No, he put his tongue down my throat in the elevator,
wow.
Okay?
Oh, okay.
And I got news for you. If it was the Serbian stallion, it wouldn't have stopped there, I'll tell you that right now. That elevator would just never have landed.
You'd hit the fire button and not moved?
It would have kept going up and down, and the elevator too, but never would. 828 votes on the poll. We got 1,000 licked, and what are we going to, we'll decide later what's a safe number to shoot for. You notice how I wait till about, noon? And then you can kind of calculate in your mind at about, 100 votes an hour. So we have 1,000 by noon, then you can go for 1,200. See what I'm saying? There's the formula for it, Chris. A little inside secret of the trade.
Okay.
Like taking line 9 is always good to get out of the way first. QAM.
Hello, this is John calling from NSBA to let the owner know that your platinum membership with your $8,000
small business credit I've been waiting for that.
Has been approved.
All right.
We're rich.
My platinum what with my $8,000 what?
Credit card.
All right. Just what I need is another credit card, not...
Oh, God, Neil.
Hey, man, how you doing? Hey, if you've been riding around your lowrider cruising for babes all day, you're probably pretty hungry right about now, right? So what you gonna do? Go home or you gotta wash your hands, keep your elbows off the table, say peace and thank you? You don't gotta do that. Come see us, cause we're...
Nacho Mama!
The new self-service Mexican restaurant.
Excuse me, I'd like the Conquistador special.
Hey, man, you can keys whatever you want. Because
huh?
I ain't going to get it for you. We're Nacho Mama.
Oh.
Nacho Mama, serving up the best of anything you want. As long as you go back and make it yourself.
That was great.
Hey, where you going? I'm going to go pick that up for you. Wash those dishes, man.
What?
So, for Tex-Mex with no respect, it's...
Nacho Mama!
Do it yourself. We're not your mama.
So anyway, you're probably wondering, how come I'm playing that? It's from the standing... and guess what? Guess
what?
Who's going to be... In fact, maybe they already were there and I missed it. At the Fallsview Casino, Niagara Falls. I got their brochure, with the entertainers. I better go in the other room and get it during the next break.
Okay.
Mary Wilson. Is it Mary Wilson or was it Mary Wells? I think Mary Wells is dead.
There's
sure
two of them.
Mary Wilson. And anyway, and the Funk Brothers.
Excellent.
The whole Motown show. I might have to just go and see that,
Good.
Unless it's already over. Anyway, your close friend Brandon says, and I have no idea what this is all about, just out of the blue, Just try to touch base with us. Touch this, Brandon. I was actually listening to an old song, but I'm sure you know, Cool Jerk by the Capitals. Not sure how old it is, but it sure sounds, sure as hell sounds old. Catchy song, though, he says. Whatever that means. Is it catchy? It's okay. Now, you probably got the Capitals in the original one, right? Because this is, I probably...
Well, stop it, you'll hear it.
I beg your pardon?
Stop yours, you'll hear mine.
Yeah. When I was good, I liked that. When I was a nice segue, they said. And a nice talk-up, too, even better for it. I'm replacing Rick Shaw, by the way, May 14 on Wagsy, on Magic, whatever the hell he's on.
Is this one of those gay songs?
Well, it's not a gay song, okay? Well, what does that mean?
I don't know what kind of lingo you people used to use back then.
Yeah. The kind of back in the day, that's the kind of lingo that all the people. What do you know about it?
Nothing.
Montana boy, what the hell do you know about it?
They got fags up there
Beater
too.
Beater boy, yeah, they got some faggots in Montana. We're everywhere. They're everywhere you go. Mm-hmm. You can't run away. Even at Disney. Even the clowns and the Mickey Mouse and all those people up there. And no, I'm not playing no more Eisner. Okay, I got that one guy, that dark complected guy in there. It's like. That old Neil thing. And then, of course, that guy turned out to be a fake anyway. What did I tell you about him? Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, brother. No, let's go there again. Okay, so anyway, there's your thing, Brandon. There you go. Cool Jerk. That's, is that Bootsy Collins? It is. I told you. Bootsy Tootsy. There goes Bootsy. Or as Mike Raneri would say, here comes somebody. I forget already what he used to say. He used to say a lot of things, none of which made any sense, but he was a good guy, Mike Raneri, and now he's dead. What are they going to say about me when I'm in the ground? What are all you people, all my close personal friends out there, going to say about me when I'm dead and buried? Oh, that old Neil, he was sure a great old gay guy. What are they going to say?
So he's an old fat fag, now he's dead.
Yeah, that's what they're going to say. and I'm going to be hurting for a certain man. I'm going to be down there in that box and be like, oh, gee, is that the best you can say about me? Oh. See, that's one thing. When you're dead, nobody can hurt your feelings.
That's right.
Not too many good things I can say about death, but that's one of them. Nobody can hurt your feelings. No bill collectors are going to come calling you, knocking on the door. No phone solicitors are going to ring your phone at 11 o'clock at night, bugging the hell out of you. None of these things. Here's some great news, as a matter of fact, that I'd rather read this news while I'm still alive. I like it. U.S. Democratic presidential candidate Barack Obama's popularity has grown among likely voters, according to a poll released yesterday, which suggested he was gaining on rival frontrunner Hillary Clinton, she's no longer the frontrunner, by the way, according to this. The poll by the Rasmussen Institute predicted that Obama would get 32% of the vote in February's primary, compared to 30%
man.
For Swillery, who until now has been the consistent favorite in the Democratic Party. How do you like that? While the report noted that it marked the first time a candidate other than Swillery came out on top, it nevertheless pointed out that Obama's percentage gain was statistically insignificant. Well, excuse me. In addition, the results were called through a Rasmussen Reports national telephone survey that was conducted April 23rd to 26th, with most answers given in advance of the first Democratic debate, which was held Thursday the 26th. Another poll next week would gauge the candidate's performance in that debate, which I didn't watch and I don't care about, and I don't want to hear about politics, you know? I don't want to see no Chris Matthews. I don't want to see no Tucker Carlson with his mother Tucker Pies and his stupid-ass bow tie he used to wear. I don't want to see none of that. All these silly-ass talking heads. It's like those Sunday morning shows, those propaganda shows. That's all they are. Why does anybody waste their time watching them? I sure don't, do you?
No.
However, the survey has shown, here's the good news, a steady decline in Hillary's support base.
All right.
Oh. Yeah. The same poll in March showed the New York senator and wife of Bill Clinton had a 12-point lead over Obama. Now she's 2 points down. She's going down. It's only May 1st, El Primero de Mayo. And thank you for correcting me on that yesterday. I'm embarrassed.
Don't worry about it.
I do. I won't. But anyway, on the 1st of May, and we're not that far away from El Cinco de Mayo. It's coming up Saturday, right? The 5th?
Si.
Oh, boy. Wow. What are we going to do for El Cinco de Mayo? You know what I did? I already celebrated yesterday. I went to Taco Bell.
Huh. I'm going to sleep in. Maybe then I'll go to Taco Bell.
For the first time in a long time, I went to Taco Bell. I must have known my gastronomic juices must have been flowing in that direction of Mexico. I must have known that it was going to be El Cinco de Mayo. Actually, it was pretty good. You know what I had? I'm not going to tell you. Too much.
Yeah, burrito, no beans.
Dude, burrito supreme. Oh, no
Jesus
beans.
Christ.
Differences were also emerging in the demographics of the two candidates' support bases. Obama, 45, the mixed-race Illinois senator. Now, what would a mixed race? Well, that sounds so bad. Why do they have to put that in there? Who was born to a white American mother and a Kenyan father, can you believe it? Leads among voters under 40. Anybody under the age of 100 is all for Barack Obama. And you want to know why? Because he's got it. I don't know what it is, but he's got it. Clinton, 59, is the strongest in the 65 and older bracket. We can only hope that most of those people are dead by Election Day. Clinton's got a 2-point edge among Democrats. Obama's got a 19-point lead among independents, likely to vote in the Democratic primary, which is 8 months away. Clinton piled up $26 million in campaign contributions, according to campaign finance disclosures released earlier this month, while Barack Obama came in a close second with $25 million. He's right on our ass when it comes to the big bucks. Nearest contender to Obama and Clinton was former Senator John Edwards with 17% likely vote in the primary, which determines the Democratic candidate. None of the other 8 Democratic contenders garnered more than 3%. I mean, when you can't even get 3%, you know, like, what's his name from Connecticut? Chris Dodd and Joe Biden, who's Biden this time, and Bill Richardson and Bobby Richardson. Who else is running? About 600 people, you know. Everybody and their brother wants to be president. They haven't got any solutions or ideas, but they all want to be president. Barack Obama's the man. Remember, I told you that first on this show about 100 years ago. Didn't I tell you that? Wasn't I the first out of the box?
Yes, you did.
And I said, he the man. And you'll see, all you doubting Thomases out there, all you Swillery supporters, man, I can't stand that bitch. She's colder than an icicle. She's colder than the inside of your freezer turned all the way down to 80 below zero. And, of course, she, you know, got all this mamby-pamby pandering to the right. And, of course, her war, she still thinks that the war maybe wasn't such a bad idea. Just Bush done it wrong, but maybe it wasn't such a bad idea after all. You know, invading and occupying another country and opening up all this terrorism and all this death and mayhem. And the 30, what is it? It's getting like close to 3,300, I think, American deaths over there, plus hundreds of thousands, maybe a million dead Iraqis. That's the price of freedom. It's expensive. Democracy is expensive, right?
Yes, it is.
So we tell them.
And freedom isn't free.
That's right. It's hard work. 876 votes. It's like that salad dressing. I told you that story in Publix a long time ago. It's a true story. I'm standing in line behind some old bag, at least 110 years old, and she's got her three or four items there in her cart, and she takes the bottle of Kraft free salad dressing, and she puts it on the counter, and the girl scans it, and she says, "Wait a minute, I thought it says free on the bottle." "It's the name of the product, you stupid old bitch. Kraft free? My name is Fink, and what do you think? I press pants for nothing? God, that's older than all of us put together, you know?" What? It is.
That's funny.
You like that, though, huh?
Yeah, I did.
Kraft free dressing. "It says free on the bottle. I got something for you for free, honey." "Yeah, my foot right where your bag sits on the floor. Well, I don't want to get my shoes bad." 876 on the poll. No sweat, Chris. You're in today. You got, thousands of dollars coming in.
Cool.
I think that's a really good idea, nifty idea. Chris, let's pay Chris.
I agree.
A penny for every vote. So if we get 3,000 votes, that's...
about 30, man.
30 bucks, right?
All right.
Why don't we go with like a dime per vote?
Dime for a vote. Okay, so we got 1,000. That would be 100 bucks. That's not a bad idea. There would be an extra 500 bucks a week for you.
Exactly.
What's that, like 6 times your salary? 10 times?
Probably about 10 times, yeah.
Too good.
Gandhiman's here. What kind of protest do you want? Sit in, lobby in, anything you want, as long as it's non-violent, you've come to the right man, because I'm the Gandhiman. Who can organize a boycott?
Organize a boycott!
Turn the other cheek.
Turn the other cheek.
But not the freedom, trouble goes to prison for a week. The Gandhiman.
The Gandhiman.
The Gandhi man can, cause he mixes it with love and makes the system look bad. Who can spot an unjust law?
Spot an unjust law.
Will even wash the trees.
Will even wash the trees.
Who can make his own clothes, not afraid to cause a scene? The Gandhi man.
The Gandhi man.
Oh, the Gandhi man can.
Oh, the Gandhi man can.
Oh, the Gandhi man can. He mixes it with love and makes the system look bad. The Gandhi man consents that he represents Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, and Asians, or the other religious persuasions, but a very few Caucasians. Who can really take a beating?
Really take a beating?
Who can really take a punch?
Really,
who can fast without a dinner or a breakfast or a lunch? The Gandhi man.
The Gandhi man.
Oh, the Gandhi man.
Oh, the Gandhi man can.
The Gandhi man can, cause he mixes it with love and makes the system look bad.
Makes the system look bad.
Yes, the Gandhi man can, cause he mixes it with love and makes the system look bad.
Oh, the Gandhi man.
Oh, I'm the all-time king of passive resistance. You'd better do what I say, or I swear I will starve myself to death.
Yeah, I'm going to do something dangerous, man. I'm going to sit and I'm not going to eat. That would be a bad idea for me, you know. Just take about an 80-day fast or take it kind of slow. At any rate, so what was I just going to tell you? Something very important that just slipped my mind. It was muy importante.
Alzheimer's.
Old-timers. I got my old-timers disease going on. I already gave the schedule for today. Let's read the schedule for the rest of the week. Then it'll be about 1:45. Oh, we got Geldy at the Dolphins Award Banquet on Thursday. You want to be sure and miss that. Okay, let's take a look at this poll today, and I don't like it. 894, though. That's what is it, 894 cents for Chris? $8.94.
Sounds good to me.
Well, you would take it, wouldn't you? We've only been on about a half an hour. You take $8 a half an hour. That's 16 bucks an hour. But you're not making those 16 bucks an hour, are you?
Yeah, definitely not.
Well, there you go. Chris just got a raise. Now, who's going to pay this 89 cent?
You?
No. An estimated 900,000 Floridians drive our roads with suspended licenses. Your response, question mark? I think this poll blows. In fact, I'm embarrassed I put it on there. But it goes to show you that loyal audience we got out there, man, no matter what kind of crap we put on there, they go and vote on it because they feel the spirit of Christ compels them, I guess. Wouldn't you think?
I imagine.
894. Confiscate their vehicles, damn it, 210. throw their asses in jail, 182. What you expect? I thought it said what the F. What you expect from the third world drivers, 161. The banana boat crowd, third world. People that came from countries that haven't been invented yet. People that came from, like, not even Banana Republic. What are those other, a plantain republic? Is that like a step below a banana republic, a plantain republic?
I
would think
so.
I bet most of them here are here in South Florida, 137. Bet you're right about that. You can't complain about the driving because there ain't none. Very little. Maybe like 5% is really driving and the rest is caca. The rest of what passes for driving in South Florida is pure unadulterated
crap.
That's it. You got it. You're catching on. Just shoot him, 91. I'm one of them, 39. Well, guess what? We're going to find your ass. We're going to round you up. Find him and slap him on the wrist, 37. That's it. Just a little slap on the wrist. And revoke their licenses permanently, 37. 894. But we're going to be at 1,000 pretty quick, according to my calculations. According to like what Mo would say, his best... What was he saying in that one bit?
I'm not going to say it.
What was it?
I don't know. That's why I'm not going to say it.
Oh. Doug Thompson writes in Capitol Hill Blue, billion bilking bush. I got a lot of material here today, man. I got a lot of stuff. I got a lot of lives to save, a lot of fish to fry, a lot of bacon to eat. Oh, I already did that. Now, did you get your bacon from Howie?
You know it. Two orders. Thank you, Howie.
Now, let me ask you this. Duff was in there this morning. I almost forgot. I guess I did forget. I was supposed to bitch her out about Char Hut. Tomorrow's Char Hut Wednesday.
Right.
And I think you guys are going to get screwed and tattooed. QAM, hello.
Mr. Rogers, top of the morning to you.
Yes, sir.
20-plus years. You're better than better.
All right.
Downtown listening to the Candyman, another great bit. And Uncle Neil, I need a favor.
Yeah.
Mr. Rogers, yes, I'm having a pleasure second time to go to Europe. I'm going to be in Germany for about 5 weeks.
Uh-huh.
I love Italian food. I know you rave about both Berlin and Cologne. And could you give me two off the top of your head, sir?
Can I give you two what?
Restaurants, Italian, trattorias.
You're the best, Neil. Come on, lay it on me.
Oh, man, trattorias. They don't got no trattorias in Germany, okay? I hate to break the news to you. If you want trattorias, go to Italia, man. No
I
trattorias.
Was recently, 2 years ago, had a ball in Italy, but my son's now in Germany. And if you're in the mood for Italian food in Berlin or Cologne, where do you
in
go?
In Berlin, there's what the hell's the big shopping center there in Berlin? The Europa Center. In the Europa Center, there's a pretty good Italian restaurant down on the lowest floor. You take the escalator down, there's a pretty good Italian. I mean, you're not going to find sensational Italian food in Germany.
I understand.
That would be like saying, can I find some good bratwurst in Roma, man?
All
the food is good. Have a great time. Enjoy the brats, man.
Neil, you're the best. And,
Neil, you already said that. Thank you. Quit kissing my ass. God, I got ass burn from that call. I got ass rash from that call. How many times did he say you're the best? I mean,
100.
At least 500, I think. You know, I know. First of all, I know I'm the best. There's nobody even close. There's nobody in the same league with this show, with this old queen. I know that. Is there any doubt about that?
No.
No, everybody knows that. And, of course, in South Florida, because they take you for granted. They take everything for granted because there's no passion. So we'll see on Friday whether we made a nice comeback if our people, wired a whole bunch of diaries or, you know, or how that's what we needed.
Yeah.
We needed people listening 7, 8, 9 hours a day to this show. It's only on for 4, but we needed 8 or 9. But we'll survive. Somehow we'll scrape through. And, of course, Chris has got that big increase now. Let's see. We got over 900 votes on there, Chris. It's $9.06 for you right now. I bet you if I click that view current, it's going to be, like I said, 906. What are some great trattorias in Czechoslovakia, in the Czech Republic? That guy. I mean, you know, he meant well, and he wanted to kissy, 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 but enough already with Jesus. That is so ponderous. Hey, Larry, you're the best, Larry.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Thank you. Hey, Larry, you're really the best, Larry.
Uh-huh.
Thank you. What's the question? Thank you. That whole deal, man. Well, I guess I don't have time for Doug Thompson right now. I have to do it right. That's not that long.
We'll wait.
Yeah, you know what? You will wait because I guess you got no choice.
Only in the Banana Republic, baby. Only in Miami.
Oh, you're a liar.
No, hey, I didn't lie, all right? All right, I'll lie.
You're all liars.
Are you calling me a liar?
Not all adults are liars.
You're lying. I'm trained to spot liars.
I'm afraid I find it difficult. Trust you.
Democrats, Republicans no longer believe in him. Alberto Gonzalez seems in big trouble. Testimony they demand. Go to Congress, take the stand. Play it cool, try to fool Capitol Hill Rumble.
I'm a liar.
I'm a loser. And I'm ashamed.
Here's a thought. He can't be trusted.
Lawyers fire, torture planned. Awful grab wire, taps, reckless loyalty. The party over country. Guantanamo right to trial. White House in complete denial. Constitution thrown away. How long till they make him pay?
Do not trust this man. Do not talk to him. Do not engage him in conversation.
Now Congress has voted to start bringing our troops home, but the president says he'll veto the bill. He was wrong then, and he's wrong now. It's the will of one nation versus the stubbornness of one man. Tell George Bush, sign the bill. Bring our troops home.
All right. Paid for by Americans United for Change. Good spot just there on CNN. Millions of people watched it, or at least 100. Is that great or what?
All right.
Well, at least it's something. You know, people are starting to... Americans are pretty slow, you know, because they got American Idol to worry about and all that. Give me the ball, give me the ball, give me that stuff, you know. The important stuff. Can't worry about all these dead bodies and all, you know, all this other crap going on.
Right. It's a bummer anyway.
It's depressing. It's depressing stuff, man. It's depressing. My name is Fink, and what do you think? I press pants for depressed pants for nothing? 924 votes on the poll. Well, we're getting close to 1,000. It's not even 11 o'clock yet. I think we're making a comeback. What do you think? Especially in light of the fact that it's after Easter and Pesach. Wow. Wowie, wow, wow. When half of South Florida bails out. How can it be the year 2007, and I can remember saying this about 100 years ago on the air, screaming about it. How can what is supposedly a major market still be a horse and buggy seasonal town? You know what I mean? Like in a real city, like in Boston or Chicago or New York, in L.A., do they talk about the season when people are going to do business and make some money and, you know, business people? Of course they don't. There is no such thing as that. In Toronto, they talk about the season? Of course not. Season my ass. With Adolph's, by the way.
Yeah, okay. I'll get
MSG
the accent.
Can't be bad. Isn't Adolph's MSG?
I don't know. Accent is.
Oh, accent is MSG. That's right. Yeah. Accent's bad for you. Don't be sprinkling a lot of accent on your...
I like it. Makes my teeth tingle.
You do like it?
Oh, yeah.
It's MSG, man. It's poor
man's acid.
A pounding headache.
Pins and needles on your face.
Needles and pins. The searchers. And then, of course, there's always Bootsy Collins. I don't want to play that. I mean, you know, with all due respect, Bootsy Collins is good. What's the other song he did on this show? Needles and Pins, the Searchers. I love that. 1963, I want to say, from one of them. Am I right?
64.
Like I wanted to say 64, but I said 63, just because I don't want to show off. This could be... Oh, this is Gerald LaVert, who just died. Oh, Christ. How could the good singers die, you know?
Everybody does.
God people out there. If God was really fair, you know, he would...
Do they yell
all
of that
version? Let's not get music intensive again here today. I don't know. That was Brandon started that. Shame on you, Brandon. I have no idea what that last email was you wrote. It was incoherent. He wrote me words on a page. You know what I mean? They didn't make any sense.
Making words
to me,
with his pen.
And I'm sure they didn't make any to him. Maybe he's doing the magic mushrooms already this morning. Doug Thompson says, billion bilking Bush. He says, the late Senator Everett Dirksen of Illinois put it best. A billion here, a billion there, Dirksen said. Pretty soon we're talking about real money. In the build-up to his questionable invasion of Iraq, President Bush and his corrupt administration told many, many lies. Iraq, he said, had weapons of mass destruction. They didn't, and many intelligence experts told the president he stood on shaky ground by claiming they did. Iraq, he said, conspired with al-Qaeda to plan the terror attacks of 9/11. He said he had proof he did not. Yet the biggest lie of all is just now surfacing. The war against Iraq, Bush said, would cost about $50 billion, give or take a billion or two. Not even close. A new report shows the cost of Bush's failed Iraq war will soon top $500 billion. Now that is, old Ev Dirksen would say, is real money. Half a trillion. McClatchy newspapers put together a list of what $500 billion would buy if we weren't blowing it on the war in Iraq. For example, a college education, tuition, fees, room and board at a public university for about half the nation's 17 million high school-age teenagers. Preschool for every 3- and 4-year-old in the country for the next 8 years. A year's stay in an assisted living facility for about half of the 35 million Americans aged 65 or older.
Oy!
You realize this November I'm going to be 65? I'm going to be like official old fart.
What
senior citizen. You're a senior citizen, Neil. You're an old fart.
Oy!
65. Now you're going to be one of those people that you know. I will never become one of those people. Anyway, Doug Thompson says when you apply the cost of the Iraq war to the U.S. population of $301.7 million, you get a cost of $1,657 for every man, woman, and child in this country. Pentagon sources say military planners warned Bush that his estimate of $50 billion for the war in Iraq was way too low, but he ignored their warnings, just like he ignored the advice of others who said they couldn't prove the existence of weapons of mass destruction or any connection between Saddam Hussein and Osama Yamama bin Laden. As former CIA Director George Tenet outlines in his new book, Bush made up his mind to invade Iraq even before he took office on January 20th, 2001. He just needed an excuse, and the attacks of 9/11 gave him that excuse. Then he invented justifications to sell the war to a shell-shocked Congress, a gullible media, and a trusting American public. The legacy of George W. Bush will be a failed presidency, a bankrupt America, and a lost war based on lies, writes Doug Thompson. But nice knowing you, Doug. They're going to come and drag your ass out of there any minute now, but it's been nice knowing you. This is a guy who spits it right out there, who dares you to deal with the truth, dares you to handle the truth. Oh, you know that guy, my favorite call yesterday of all the idiots, and we have so many, was the guy that called, did you get an email from Vijay Singh, that Indian friend? That guy.
Yeah.
I got news for him, okay? I'm going to Google over anybody I want to on here, including my friend the Serbian. He also mentioned him, Serbian Stallion. He must have heard that the other day because I got two things from him today. Two things. One was his, and I think one was his wife's. I didn't know she had one, though. 938 votes. Now, did you forgot already. You're just so wishy-washy.
About what?
About his, he's 18, I think. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you're right. I forgot, meaning I didn't even
about
remember
the wife.
In the first place.
She was
place.
Cute.
Okay.
They made a really cute couple. Oh, and speaking of El Primero de Mayo today, Cuba's Revolución Plaza was packed today with hundreds of thousands of cheering workers celebrating May Day, but Fidel was nowhere to be seen. And, of course, Hugo Chavez is saying he's back in charge, he's be doing great, yada, 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 and a partridge in a pear tree. And he also said,
"Incredible."
Does anybody believe me? No. The 80-year-old Comunista leader was not watching from his usual perch atop a viewing platform and hasn't been seen in public since that emergency intestinal surgery forced him to step down temporarily 9 months ago. As they say in Little Havana, his kishkis are bleeding. Oh, did I mention on the air about Jeff Rimmer?
I don't think so.
I spoke to him yesterday. His wife called and he put him on the phone. He had quadruple bypass surgery last Friday. He's okay. He had quadruple bypass. He was having shortness of breath and like a little this, a little that. He went to the doctor and they said, oh, you got to have two. He did the stress test, you know. And you got two arteries blocked. And when they opened him up, they found all four arteries were blocked. And they went, oy, a clog. And so he had quadruple bypass, but he's okay. And he came on the phone and pop, pop, pop. I said, boy, nothing can shut you up, can it? And I said, it must have been all that artery clogging food you ate, all those big steaks and juicy meals that I fed you at great expense. And he went, but anyway, he's okay. I mean, I know that you don't like him very much, but, you know.
But what?
You certainly don't wish him any ill physically. I mean,
no, I just don't care one way or another.
Oh, well, so I'm sure there are people out there who care. Maybe like Denise Potvin is here and there. I'm sure Denise...
His wife's very nice, though.
Yeah, Farrell is great. She's not just very nice. She's a sweetheart. I love her like crazy. In fact, if I only had to deal with her, the whole family would have gotten along a lot better. Now, that's bad to say when he's recovering from quadruple bypass. Castro's attended the annual International Workers' Day march for decades. Cuban officials had refused to speculate on whether he would use this year's event to make his first public appearance since undergoing surgery and temporarily ceding his duties to his 75-year-old brother, Maricón.
Yay.
Raúl. One of Castro's main allies, Venezuelan President Hugo Chavez, said Sunday that the Cuban leader is once again in charge, but he declined to comment on statements by Bolivia's leftist leader that Castro could appear in public May 1, meaning today. He ain't appearing in public. There was no word on Cuban state television's nightly newscast. Castro issued the latest in a new series of communiques calling for a revolution in energy production, but gave no hint of whether he'd make a May Day appearance. They brought in Rick Jenneret. He's screaming, May Day, May Day, May Day. He's doing that routine again. It's old and tired, but it's funny. Mayday. He reiterated his opposition to U.S. plans to use food crops to produce ethanol for cars, predicting that American fuel needs to be provided with the labor of the world's impoverished sugarcane workers. Tomorrow, the 1st of May, is a good day to carry these reflections to the workers and all of the poor people of the world, Castro wrote in the communique dated last night. A wooden platform on the broad plaza of the Revolution was decorated for the May Day event with huge banners bearing portraits of the island's Comunista heroes, but the urgent need by many to see the man who ruled this country for 47 years seems to have faded in recent months as life has continued normally, at least for them, under the leadership of Castro's younger brother, Raúl,
Yay.
The defense minister. Occasional government photos and videos of the elder Castro have assured Cubans he's still alive and recovering, appearing stronger and more robust in the most recent images. There will be similar marches in smaller marches in cities around the island, with the government expecting several million of the nation's how many million does that say? I can't read it. It's blotted out. Million to participate in those. How many million in Cuba? I can't read the number.
Like 10 last time I checked.
Oh. Those gathered will also protest the recent decision to free on bond anti-communist leader, a militant Luis Posada Carriles, for pending his trial on U.S. immigration charges. Havana accuses the Cuban board Posada of orchestrated 1976 airliner bombing that killed 73 people, a charge he denies. Luis Posada. I wonder if he's related to Isabel de Casada. Isabel de Casada. Channel of whatever news. Oh, boy. All these people, all these Julio people talking Spanish baby talk on South Florida TV. Another reason not to be there. Isabel de Casada, Nicaragua. Castro has met in recent weeks with Colombian writer and Nobel laureate Gabriel Garcia Marquez and top Chinese Communist Party leader, and has penned four editorials, including the one he shoot last night. He's writing up a storm, that Fidel man. He's strong, he's wrong, and Hubmandreard. That's what they're saying in Sweetwater, Hubmandreard. They don't even know what it means, but I think they got a good point. To hell with Fidel. That's what that means. 9:49 on the poll. We're going to go over 1,000 next hour, Chris, and then they'll fear you. Then you got $10. $10 in your pocket.
Not too bad.
You can save that all for that next big trip to Vegas. That $10, I would say, the way things are right now, get you out, maybe out to, I don't know, middle of the state. In fact, maybe you can go to the Miccosukee. Isn't that out there in the middle of the, where is the Miccosukee?
Out there in the on the res.
West,
isn't
yeah.
it? Yeah. Out there on Alligator Alley? Well, there you go. $10 gas and leave you a couple bucks left over and putting a machine on. Maybe you'll hit that hot machine. Maybe you'll win like $1 million with that machine. What do you think, Chris?
Yeah, I got it.
No.
This is the Neil Rogers Show.
You failed.
This is your brain. Any questions?
I hear on TV every all the word is an obscenity.
All right.
It used to be the cable was a whole lot worse, but now the networks let their actors curse. There's no end in sight to this insanity. All the dialogue contains profanity. Swearing like a sailor on a 3-day pass. Words a whole lot worse than ass.
Wrecked them.
F-bomb, how long will it be before they drop the F-bomb on network TV? F-bomb, there's no telling when they'll drop one on the UPN.
Ah, crap, I got some bad news for me.
What's that?
The Magic of Motown. I just remember I said I better run in the other room during the break.
Mm-hmm.
That brochure from Fallsview Casino in Niagara Falls, Ontario. And here it is. It's in my hand right now in the brochure, too. Dolly Parton's going to be there May 10. That's a week from a Thursday. Anybody want to see her with those big old saggy boobies? No. Michael Bolton, May 24th. Oh, God. Roger Hodgson, formerly of Supertramp. I love Supertramp, by the way.
Mm-hmm. What about
him? In fact, what's the Supertramp song I have in here? Is it Hello, Stranger? No, I don't have that. Hello, Stranger is not. What's the name of it?
Goodbye, Stranger.
Goodbye. Well, Hello, Stranger was Barbara Lewis. And then they came back with Goodbye, Stranger, just to be bastards. I got all those Goodbye songs in there. Goodbye, Marlins. Goodbye, Patty. Phil Hartman.
Take the Long Way Home. Is that the one that you have from the Magnolia?
No. I don't think I have any of them in here. Well, that's not possible. I have that. Well, who the hell really cares, you know? The audience doesn't care about that. Here we go. I love Supertramp.
Me too.
One of the most underrated groups of all time.
I was up before the dawn.
John Stewart's going to be there Friday, June 1st and Saturday, June 2nd. Maybe he'll be funny there because he sure isn't on my TV. Maybe he's funny on other people's TVs, you know? He's just not funny on my TV. Huey Lewis in the News, Wednesday, June 6th. Grand Funk Railroad, Friday, June 8th. They're going to be doing Locomotion, and Little Eva's going to be rolling over in her grave. I think she's still alive. Urethra Franklin, Peter Frampton, Hart. There's some good people there. Doobie Brothers, Donna Summer, Jay Leno. Bobby Vinton's going to be there Thursday.
Oh, boy!
Oy vey. She wore blue velvet. Anyway, kill that. Take the long way home. The Magic of Motown, starring Mary Wilson of the Supremes and the Funk Brothers. Isn't that what I said? See, I had my information right, but the dates, oh, a pox on them. June 14th and 15th, that's when I start my next vacation. I can't be canceling my vacation to go see the Funk Brothers as much. I would love to see that. Maybe you'll go there.
If I get some free tickets, yeah.
Free tickets for what?
Is it free already?
Oh, I could get it free for the tickets, but how are you going to get there? You're going to spring to fly to Toronto or Buffalo and then take a limo to Niagara Falls?
No.
And then pay for the room?
I have to get free tickets to that, too.
I could get you comp there, the room and the meals.
I'll pass.
But I won't because you can't afford to go there, so yeah. That's the problem. Well, once you got there, you'd be okay. I can get you comp with all kinds of good stuff. But then getting there and getting back home, although why would you want to get back home? You could just stick a foot in the falls there and say, hey, goodbye, cruel world. Right. Goodbye, cruel world.
Take the long way home.
Darren? Did James Darren do that? Goodbye, cruel world? I think he did. And I bet you got that. He sure. Looking. Could he sing or what, James Dearen?
No, I got the Pink Floyd version, not the James
Dearen. Well, that's okay. Spirit of Broadway. Philippe Gagnon. Some frog. Who the hell is he?
Mm.
Oh, he's an impressionist. Nonsense is going to be there. Nonsense. Little Sisters of Hoboken. Songwriter's Night. There are a whole bunch of good stuff. But anyway, so June, if you want to go see at Niagara Falls, it falls you. Magic of Motown, June 14th and 15th, live at the Fallsview Casino Resort. Can I read the blurb? Because you know how much I love that whole thing.
I know you want to leave.
If Ben Harper was going to be there and Joan Osborne, I would push my trip back a week or something. You believe me?
No.
It sounds good, though, doesn't it? Because I just love the Funk Brothers and that whole Standing in the Shadows of Motown. It just changed my life. Thanks, Suds. Marvin Gaye, the Supremes, the Temptations, Smokey Robinson, the Miracles, the Four Tops, and so many more known as legendary Motown artists, yet they are not the musicians who created the Motown sound we know and love today. In 1959, Berry Gordy began to gather a group of musicians from the thriving blues and jazz scene in Detroit, Michigan, for his new record company, Motown. Motown. Not that Mo. This group was made up of the best musicians in the industry, and they called themselves the Funk Brothers. That's with an N. The Funk Brothers performed on every Motown recording during the musical era, and they're still best-kept secret in the history of pop music. They played on more number one records. Listen to this.
Mm-hmm.
They played on more number one records than the Beatles, the Beach Boys, the Rolling Stones, and Elvis combined. All of these things. More number one records than the Beatles, the Beach Boys, the Rolling Stones, and Elvis combined. Experience the rare opportunity to relive the magic of Motown as the original dream girl, Mary Wilson, the Supremes, joins this group of unsung heroes live on stage. Can't help myself to perform your favorite Motown hits such as Baby Love, Stop in the Name of Love, Come See About Me, You Can't Hurry Love, and Sugar Pie Honey Bun by the Four Tops.
Sugar Pie Honey Bun.
Now that's not on here, is it? Not on the disc.
Right.
Same old song.
Yes, it is. I still like it.
It's Jimmy and Danny and Danny and Jimmy. That was the Danny and Jimmy up, by the way. And then, of course, there's my... Go up, reach out, and it'll be there. Reach out and grab it. Joan Osborne, baby. She ain't no Ozzy Osborne. She ain't even Donny Osmond born. She's the best. So what are we going to do about Rick Shaw's retirement on May 14th? Is that the day? Now look at the calendar for me.
I'll smoke a bowl for him. How's that?
Okay, good. Look on the calendar and see what day of the, let's see, today's the
Monday.
First, so next Tuesday is the 8th. Monday the 14th, so I guess Friday preceding that will be Ricky Tikki's last day on the air. He doesn't work Saturday, does he? The guy's been on, that's 85 years old.
I'm going to call him and give him the hotline just in case, you know.
Why, you got his number?
Yeah.
Oh, that would be great. God, I'd love to say farewell to Ricky Tikki Shaw on the air. In fact, just one last time, I think it would be a real treat to have him come online and say...
It's a lie. I am not a Nazi.
I think that would be great.
Calling him right now.
You are?
Yeah.
Well, we don't want to do it today.
I'm not on the air. I'm just telling him, here's the number. Call in when you got something to say, or if you don't.
No, don't do it today. I don't want to talk to him today. I mean, I wouldn't mind talking to him today, but I don't want to do that. It's 2 weeks away, for Christ's sakes. Yeah, your timing is so, that's your whole thing in life, in case you haven't noticed that.
Yeah, well, that's one of my problems, sure.
Yeah, timing is everything, man. Being in the right place at the right time. And in your case,
mm-hmm.
981 votes on our very marginal poll today. I'm embarrassed by it. I'll be the first one to admit I think this poll sucks. Then why did you put it on there? Charlie B has sent you 6,000. I got a pile of polls here to the ceiling. Here's one, for example. What annoying noise could make you drive? Could most drive you to murder the son of a bitch who makes it? Should I read you the list?
Okay.
Leaf blower, dog barking, train horns on trains or vehicles, lawnmower, car horn, ringtone, Rita Cosby's voice, siren or burglar alarm. Is she still on the air? They finally drag her ass off of there.
Yeah, buddy.
I don't watch that MSNBC, neither does anybody else, especially now that Keith is off my list after he got help get Amos fired. I don't think she's on there.
Signed this bill before she left for California over the weekend.
Oh, there's Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi. Boy, talk about the weekend limp. Wow. How sad. 981 votes. An estimated 900,000 Floridians drive our roads with suspended licenses. Your response. Suspended a sentence. Suspended a license. That's a great scene. Suspended a sentence. She kept her honor. Every scene is a great scene. Let's get Godfather Intensive again. That's the poll question. Should we get Godfather Intensive or should we get Motown Intensive? That's the question. Or how about the Godfather sings Motown? Huh? Don Corleone sings What Becomes of the Broken Heart. It was an accident and somebody got hurt.
It broke my heart. Broken hearted.
Anyway, confiscate their vehicles, these slime balls, 238. Throw their asses in jail, 196. What you expect from third world drivers, 182 in the Banana Republic. There's nothing wrong with that choice, 182. Getting a lot of votes, and rightfully so. I bet most of them are here in South Florida, 148. Just shoot them, 104. Shoot them. Don't shoot them like in the head or anything like that, because we don't want to advocate.
Shoot them in the leg.
Right. I'm one of them, 41. Well, guess what? We hate you like poison and wish you would die. And you keep driving like that, and you probably will. And so will a lot of other innocent people who are pain in the ass bystanders. Fine them and slap them on the wrist. Remember Clemenza's telling him about the pain in the ass bystanders in the restaurant? About dropping the gun after he shoots McCluskey and Saluzzo?
Mm-hmm.
Don't want no pain in the ass bystanders getting, whatever he says. Pete Clemenza, man, he was so great. And what was the line that you keep were arguing with me about where he says, what was that line?
I'm thinking, Luca Brasi sleeps with the fishes.
Was that the line?
And I don't keep arguing about it.
You're right. With the fishes.
I mean, how can you not know? I mean, I don't want to, start attacking you, brutally and viciously, although I will anyway.
Go ahead. You already did.
Sleeps with the fishes.
That's so obviously Clemenza, man. You're just, a pretender.
Yeah.
Fine them and slap them on the wrist, 40, and revoke their license permanently, 38. Take their licenses away and turn them into mincemeat. Turn them into halva. Turn them into, borscht. And what was the other? Chrain, horseradish. So you don't know your horseradish because you don't know your gefilte fish. That's the problem.
Well, maybe I'll work on that.
Yeah, work on your gefilte fish.
Pacemaker has got a new CD entitled Larry King Sings Bob Marley.
We're jamming. I want to jam it with you. Tulsa, Oklahoma. Hello.
You'll dig this legendary newsman's interpretations of an even more legendary songwriter.
Chick-a-boom, chick-a-boom. He shot the sheriff. That's why he'll be my guest. Right after these words from Garlic, it's magnifique.
Larry King sings Bob Marley, only as Larry King can.
One love. One heart. Let's forget the fact that I've had 15 bypass operations.
Get Larry King Sings Bob Marley today. To order your copy, send $3 million to cover the cost of his child support payments to Larry King Live, care of CNN.
No woman, no cry. The alimony check's in the mail, honey. Stop your griping. No woman, no cry. Hey, guys, slow down a bit.
Okay, 11:17. We got 1,006 votes on there, Chris. That's $10.06 theoretically for you.
I'll take it.
Maybe Josh Cortis ought to pay it that, since he didn't seem in any big hurry to cash that check.
Remember he said he cashed it yesterday, so.
Yeah, likely story. Doesn't show up on my thing, on my bank, online. What time did he cash it yesterday? When the moon comes over the mountain, did he break in like about 9 o'clock last night when the bank was closed and say, hey, give me the money, honey?
I'll be sure to ask him when I see him next.
No, you don't have to ask. Hey, listen, the longer he hangs on to it, the more I got. That's more for me tomorrow. You know, I'm going to need all I can get at Woodbine because I'm going early. I'll be there before 1 o'clock, before the little hand hits the big hand, because we're out of here at 12:30 tomorrow. I just mentioned that in passing for all you baseball fans. Oh, yeah. Marlins at the Mets. Marlins pregame show, 12:30 tomorrow. I checked that New York weather. It's going to be sunny and in the low 60s. It's going to be beauteous. No threat of rain and no problem. And guess what's on after the Marlins-Mets game tomorrow?
Ow!
Wow. Well, that's because the Humpers got all that Louisville stuff. You know, he's got to do the ESPN stuff. We come way down the line, you know, when it comes to some of the big celebrities on our station. We come way down the line. The kind of nickels and dimes these guys are making from us funny. When they got the TV. The TV stuff is the big stuff. Then the FM, and then us. WQAM, hello.
Hi, Neil. How you doing there?
Okay, sir.
All right, that last poll suggestion inspired me to ask you, like, in Toronto, do you guys have these people running around with the bass blasting, making your eyeballs all jiggle around, or is that just Miami?
Yes, we do, absolutely.
Yeah,
yes, we
do.
Absolutely
so we
do.
Can add that to the poll when you set it up.
Okay.
Just a thought. Neil, love your show, and George, too, when you're not around.
Well, oh, shucks.
He never stole a freight train.
I swear, you guys are great. Bye.
Thanks, Pally.
Bye.
Okay, now there sound like a good guy, you know? He sounds like a real person, for crying out loud. That's scary. Mark it down, 11:19 on Tuesday, El Primero de Mayo. El Uno de Mayo.
Oui.
Saturday, El Cinco de Mayo. Don't we have a bit about this station?
Yes, we do.
It's not the one about the Mexicans. Is
of
it about
course
people?
It is. It's Mexican Independence Day. What else would it be about?
Oh, but I played that a million times.
May 5th, Cinco de Mayo.
A Mexican national holiday.
Yeah, that's enough of it. I play it too much. We don't want to play the thing about delousing Mexicans. That sounds like some kind of a, I don't know.
What?
Something that was some
something
racial,
yeah.
That's something Lou Dobbs would say, you know. 10-10 on the poll. 10-10 wins New York or 10-10 CFRB Toronto, eh? They used to have like a little bell they would ring. Was it on 10-10 wins New York or? Yeah, like that. 10-10 wins New York. Back in the day when Murray the K was on here, Murray Kaufman. So I want to take back what I said about Joyce Kaufman, because I said that I don't know anybody else with that last name who pronounced it that way. George S. Kaufman pronounced it that way, who used to be on panel shows 1,000 years ago, back with, what's her name that just died? Kitty Carlisle.
Okay.
And Dorothy Kilgallen. All of Chicken X buddies. And Bennett Thurf. And who is the other one that pronounced it that way? Beats me. Well, there was, who's the other Kaufman? Kaufman.
Andy?
No, not Andy Kaufman. It'll come to me. WQAM, hello.
Boy, I can tell that summer.
Yeah, me too. WQAM, hello.
Oh.
Is that the Whisperer, by the way, that one? I'm
no.
Not really sure. Oh, that's a different one? The Whisperer vanished. I think somebody got his ass. They hit him with 5 shots, and he ain't still alive. Yeah, they got to the Whisperer. They find. So all you know, game players out there, sooner or later, man, sooner or later, they're going to trace the call, and they're going to get to your ass, and it's just like, you just vanish. You go off to one of those camps, the summer camp, and I'm not talking about Bello Snyder's summer camp. Oh, and Dick Feinberg, you're a great guy, but don't ever call him again, please. Talk about a showstopper. He's a great guy and a good friend and yada, 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 and means well, but, oh, that call yesterday. Talk about a showstopper. Talk about stopping your momentum, boy. And what am I going to do? I'm not going to hang up on him because he's a good guy and a great friend, and he meant well and yada, yada, and he's got the bat line, and he knows how to use it.
Give him your home number, and then he won't have to call
it. He's got my home number, and if he doesn't have it, he can have it anytime he wants it, because we could have had that conversation off the air, and we could probably have, like, 4 times the audience left after he finally, we went from exuberance and the phone smoking and just ringing off the hook to, like, oh, my God, like a death knell. I hope he's not listening right now, because he'll feel bad about that. I know he didn't intend that, you know?
Right.
I mean, you want to start talking about upstate New York and harness racing. Oh, geez. WQAM, hello.
My name is Joe.
567-0560. Come on, let's get this phone cranking today, man. We're really kicking it ancient style today. Can't you feel it? I can smell it. And we got 1015 on the poll, 1015 vote on a really crappy poll. I think we're making a little bit of a comeback in spite of that lead-in. I mean, so when are they going off? Well, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have put you on the spot like that.
What? I'm sorry.
I was just thinking out loud, you know, about that morning show and how long that's going.
Oh, no!
Yeah. course, Friday the numbers come out, the book. Won't that be something, huh?
It'll be something one way or another.
It'll be something. I can't say the word on the air. It begins with an S. Well, it could be, the S could be stupendous or sensational or some other word that begins with an S. Mm-hmm. WQAM, hello.
Oh, God.
Yes.
This is Hawaii Brad. I'm calling from the Philippines, listening on the Internet. It's awesome.
It is, huh? You're in the Philippines?
I am in the Philippines, Cebu City.
I'll be damned.
Yeah, I've been here for 5 weeks. I'll be here for three more, then going back to Hawaii. So that's home now. I got out of South Florida about 3 years ago.
You got out of South Florida and home is Hawaii now? Jesus, what a lucky stiff you are, man. People are foaming at the
moment. It was one of the polls you did that partly inspired me. It said, where would you live if you could go anywhere in the world? And Hawaii won by a lot.
Well, where the hell did you steal all the money to be able to afford to live in Hawaii? Isn't it prohibitive expensive to live there?
Well, I sold your Corvette.
That must be it, yeah.
Yeah, help me out. Yeah, I did all right on my house in Florida. Yeah, and so, yeah, we're kind of taking it easy there in Hawaii, and I think in about a year or so we're going to be living here in the Philippines permanent.
Oh. I was all enthused for a minute. Well, good luck to you, Pally. Okay, and call us again when you get the oxygen in. Didn't it sound like he was gasping for oxygen a little
bit? Well, he did say he was in the Philippines.
Oh. 1,021 votes on the poll, man. Life is sweet. Things are really moving along. And I think next Thursday, I want to maybe double-check that schedule. Next Thursday, we get out of here at 11:30.
Really?
I don't think, ever done that?
I don't know.
Hour and a half show? I mean, is it really worth my while coming in for that?
You bet.
Coming in from that, coming all the way
from
home. Very
important. Very important.
That's
coming
right.
Coming
out of my bathroom and my kitchen,
cocoon,
making the bacon
right.
All the way into this little studio.
Out of your
here.
Coffin, out of your crypt. That's right.
Oh. WQAM, hello.
Obama!
WQAM, hello.
Hey, can I speak to Neil?
Speaking.
Neil.
Yes.
Nobody hangs up on me.
Wow.
I said, nobody hangs up on me. Click.
He showed you.
He showed me a thing or two. The first one was his...
Rectum.
Yeah. And then his brain, which looked just like...
Rectum.
Same thing. Yeah, same place, same thing. 1027 on the poll. Don't forget we got the Mad Dog. So what was the... maybe Chris heard some of the scuttlebutt about the draft. Were we, like, sucking up and making excuses? I did hear the early... Now, Mandich made a really good point yesterday, and that is from the marketing standpoint. He was asking Curtis, which the two of them, by the way, are a little bit too close for me. I get uncomfortable, you know? Even being the old fag that I am, it sounds a little bit too incestuous, those two. But he was asking Captain Curtis about the marketing thing, and don't they ever take that into consideration when they make their draft picks? And the 10,000 Brady Quinn T-shirts would have been sold already, and people would have been knocking the doors down to buy all that paraphernalia, and it would have been a marketing coup had they signed Brady Quinn. Don't they take that into consideration? And they both agreed,
no
they don't, which is probably not a really smart idea. But then again, we trust them because they know not what they do.
Meridians, dumb as dirt.
Putting all the time on computers. Putting all the time on computers. Putting all the time on computers. Putting all the time on
right now. The Nazi weasel ghoul from the GOP. Who's this foreign fool to help the neocons cheat? Throw them in the street and stack them in a big heap. And set them all on fire till they melt out from the heat.
Putting all the time on computers.
Absolutely.
Point on the time of computers.
Yes.
Point on the time of computers.
You fairy.
Point on the time of computers.
Break them into pieces. Smash them with a bat. Destroy them all today. No one's gonna miss them. They don't work anyway. If Democrats don't go back in 1964, if only one before there ain't no Democrats at all.
Point on the time of computers.
We gotta stop the cheating.
Point on the time of
even Geldy's getting upset about that vote. Boy, that Geldy, calm him down, okay? Calm his ass down. Maybe his voice will drop an octave or two. Just embarrassing. 11:32, 28 till noon. So speaking of movies, why is it, and you told me this before, and that is that anybody under the age of 100 will watch Network for the first time. Like I turned our close personal friend Ricky onto Network, and he watched it, and he enjoyed it, but he said the first half of it was really slow.
Yeah.
It dragged. Mm-hmm. And then he said,
"Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore."
He said that. But he enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike Josh Cordes, who fell asleep or whatever in the middle of it. And I mean, his attitude about it was unacceptable.
Listen to me. Television is not the truth. So turn off your television sets. Turn them off right in the middle of the set.
I have chosen you to preach this, Mr. Beale.
Why me?
Because you're on television, dummy.
Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Oh!
Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Oh!
Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Oh!
Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Oh!
That's what they were screaming after the Dolphins announced their draft pick on Saturday.
Crime is mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Oh!
But it's a little slow in the beginning, I guess. I don't know. To me, it's one of the most phenomenal movies. And Paddy Chayefsky, that movie was in 1972, and here it is, 2007, and we've lived through the age of BS news, you know, the Channel 7 thing, all the hysterical bleeds at Leeds, and all the hysterical bullcrap, you know, and the Ricky Tikki Sanchez's of the world, and all the celebrity gossip crap. And, you know, he was a Prussian. They fought World War I over him, Paddy Chayefsky. And he also wrote and did the Hospital. George C. Scott, did you ever see that?
Yes, I did.
That's another great movie.
Yes,
The Hospital. There's another recommendation for you. Now, Ricky says to me, The Pusher, parts 1 and 2, and it sounds familiar, but I haven't Googled it. Is it, I haven't IMDb'd it. Is that a good movie?
The what now?
Pusher.
I don't think I've seen it.
If you like her, Pusher.
Sure.
Off the Edge of a Cliff.
Okay.
In fact, what was that movie that Matt Dillon was in?
A Kiss Before Robert, Dying.
A Kiss, boy, you're good on
Remake.
That one. Every time I bring that up. The original was with Robert Wagner when he was young and looked really... Really, I mean, really good. I mean, but, you know, and of course, now he's old and foolish. Like some of us. And then the sequel was Matt Dillon, wasn't it?
Correct. And Sean
Positive. Young. And I'm not a big Matt Dillon fan. The two movies he was in, wasn't it Drugstore Cowboy?
Right.
Was very good.
Mm-hmm.
And A Kiss Before Dying was very good. Other
Crash?
Than Matt,
Crash?
And Crash.
Yes.
How could I forget Crash?
Who wasn't good in there? Everybody was good in there.
Everybody was good in there. That movie. And then we get these idiots. How could you recommend Crash?
We got one.
Movie?
We got one idiot.
No,
yeah.
We've had a few of these guys.
One. I remember one.
The same one calling over and over.
Same voice as contrary
idiot.
To everything you said.
Jackass.
Yeah.
Simpleton, man. Your taste is in your tush. Anybody that didn't like Crash. I might just watch it again sometime this week just out of protest. Crash. Former CIA analyst claims that falsified documents, which were meant to show that Iraq's Saddam Hussein's regime had been trying to procure yellowcake uranium from Niger, can be traced back to Vice President Dick Cheney. Oh, no, what a concept. As Dennis Kucinich would say, impeach his fat ass now. Appearing on MSNBC's Tucker Carlson show, Ray McGovern, who served in the CIA for 27 years, said the forged memo leads right back to the doorstep of the vice president of the USA. According to McGovern, former CIA director George Tenet told his coterie of malleable managers at the CIA to create a national intelligence estimate to the terms of reference of Dick Cheney's speech of August 26, 2002, where Cheney said for the first time, Saddam Hussein could have nuclear weapon in a year. He's got all kinds of chemical, he's got all kinds of biological weapons. And Cheney, of course, all kinds of lies. McGovern, who at one time chaired national intelligence estimates and prepared the president's daily brief, also claimed to have evidence that the memo leads directly back to Cheney, but he wouldn't say what it was, except that the names of the people involved were in the public domain. In an op-ed posted at BuzzFlash, McGovern argues, if any good can come out of the intelligence policy debacle regarding Iraq, it would be the clear lesson that intelligence crafted to dovetail with the predilections of policymakers can bring disaster. The role that Tenet, McLaughlin, and their small coterie of malleable managers played as willing accomplices in the corruption of intelligence has made a mockery of the verse chiseled into the marble at the entrance to the CIA headquarters, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. McGovern also calls Tenet a pathetic figure who's trying to justify himself for unjustifiable activity. Tenet, in his new book, claims that the Bush administration distorted his use of the term slam dunk in reference to intelligence that ultimately led to the Iraq War. You know, it's one thing about all these guys, Richard Clark, Paul O'Neill, George Tenet, while they were in office, while they were part of the administration, they kept their mouths shut, man. And then all of a sudden they decided afterward to write a book. You know what I mean? But it was too late. When the horse was out of the barn, baby, Katie bar the door. That's another stupid old expression. Katie bar the door. First of all, who the hell is Katie? And bar what door? You know what I mean? Maybe it's the door of the bar.
I don't know.
Katie bar the door my ass. 1,051 votes. We say these things and we hear these things and just you repeat them by rote. Remember Kyle Rote, who played for, played soccer, actually, once upon a time?
No.
Kyle Rote. I'm confused now. Was that the father that played for the Giants on the team when Frank Gifford was on, Kyle Rote, and the son was the soccer player? Chris ought to know that. He's a big soccer fan. Not.
Huh?
You better get with your soccer, mister, because I'm going to tell you if my buddy ever comes to town. What's his name, the great soccer player, the greatest one in the world? Not David Beckham. The
Mario
guy.
Huh? Raj.
Pele.
Mark. John. Luke.
You start with that Goyesha stuff again? John Luke. How about Matthew? That sounds good. 1059 on the poll. Now, what's the goal on the poll? You think we can do another 13 today? Wow, wouldn't that be something? I don't think so.
I do.
I'm saying 1250 would be nice. Let me write that down. So you don't know from Pusher? Am I going to have to look that up during the break?
That is correct. I don't know from it.
Well, I mean, I'm getting the high recommendations on that. At least from Ricky, anyway. Heavy duty. He says Pusher 1, Pusher 2, Pusher down the flow.
Right. Pusher over.
Pusher over.
Careful.
Why isn't that the holiday we just had? We had Easter and Pusher over. All you silly people out there with your matzahs and with your Easter eggs and with your Easter bunnies. Like I said, enjoy life, baby, because if you get bogged down in the mung of the universe, in the mung of the earth, you're going to get really depressed. You're going to ask yourself, what the hell is going on here, man? What are these crazy people acting so crazy about? What are they saying? What are they spending all their time and energy and money on besides hate and death, destruction, stuff like that? All of these things. Give me that good old-time religion, baby. What do you say? Let's have our own... I think that's what we ought to do after I sign my extension for another 10 years. The Neil Rogers Church of the Year. We can make some real good... Have everybody send in $1 a day. We'll give Chris a couple of pennies. Yeah, we'll give you a cut, you know, just like in Godfather 3 when they were sitting there on the roof in Havana.
Mm-hmm.
On the roof of that casino. And Hyman Roth says, a piece for the so-and-so. I wish I could remember the names. I wish I remember that speech. It was very good.
Mm-hmm.
That was the only time in the whole movie that he was really good. What was the actor's name? Cristiano Ronaldo, by the way, is the soccer player. See, when you get this old, you remember...
Who?
Cristiano Ronaldo.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to remember that.
I got news for you. I remember him, not the name. I remember the face. The face and the place in his space. Hey, Cristiano, now you're starting to get the drift of it?
Mm-hmm.
He's supposed to be now the greatest soccer player in the world, so they say. Doesn't he play for Real Madrid? It's your people, maybe. It's your ancestors.
Are they?
Your Catalans or whatever they are. I don't know what they are.
Are they a Spaniard?
They speak with a lisp, yeah. I know that.
They're kin.
They kin.
That's what I heard.
For me, they kin. Now, what was I saying before that I was forgetting about? The actor that played from the actor's studio. He's dead now.
James Lipton? Hyman,
huh?
Lee Strasberg.
Lee Strasberg, very good. He's dead. That was God's punishment. The saddest thing is that Eli Wallach is still alive. He ate 10 more of those cannoli, and he's still alive. Bastard.
Holy oliva, che pane.
Oh, he was just...
I thought we could reason together.
You know, I know that you like to argue with me about that movie, about how grotesque, and you're right. I mean, it's just sad because it could have been done well, and the message was, the story was really great.
Right. Well, that makes it even worse because it was, like, wasted. Nobody's going to pay any attention to it.
You had to be wasted to watch it, to be honest with you. 19 till noon already. Holy cow, time is flying. Sometimes I feel like time is passing us by, you know?
July, this is Larry King, and they don't come any better than Neil Rogers.
He's bad, and he's mad. James Brown is Agent 00 Soul in License to Chill. James Brown faces his greatest nemesis yet, the South Carolina Correctional System. Watch the Godfather of Soul sidestep the authorities with his good foot dance. The South Carolina Maximum Security Pin is no match for James Brown's sex machine. You'll be shaken, not stirred, by James Brown, Agent 00 Soul in License to Chill.
Pick up these classics in a video store near you. James Brown in Dr. Yo and Soulfinger.
And you know what Yo spells backward.
Oi!
11:46, 14 till noon at QAM. We got Mad Dog coming up at 2 with more Brady Quinn excuses. I don't know. He did make a very good point yesterday about the marketing thing, you know. But I guess they don't pay any attention to those kinds of things. Marketing, putting asses in the seats, whipping up excitement, you know. Let me ask Chris this question. Do you think that the town is excited about Ted Ginn Jr.? Huh?
Not yet, no.
No, that wasn't not yet. I'm asking
right
you now.
No, I don't think they are. But
well, there you go.
Come
now, if
season,
they would have drafted Brady Quinn on Saturday,
they'd
be excited about Brady Quinn, the mighty Quinn. You bet your sweet ass they would be, mister. Let me tell you that right now. They'd be jumping up and down. They'd like Rumpelstiltskin in Heat.
And if in 2 years he was a flop, they would be saying the
adult stuff. They'd say, well, you know, well, so big deal. But in the meantime, they'd sell a lot of crap. And why do you keep insisting he's going to be a flop? I'm telling you, he wouldn't have been a flop. Flop on this.
You would know this because...
Because I watched him play a lot, those Notre Dame games, man. And believe me, the pain in my brain from watching Notre Dame play, not only do I despise Notre Dame, I don't want to see their games. To show you how far Bisson the church is, they're the only college team that's got their own network. Am I right? Doesn't NBC do all the Notre Dame games?
That would be correct.
That is correct. And that's because the Pope put in the fix, that's why. Because the Pope paid off the Peacock, that's why NBC does all the damn Notre Dame games. Does Michigan State have its own network?
No.
Michigan?
No.
Ohio State?
No.
USC?
No.
UCLA?
No.
University of Rochester?
No.
Buffalo?
No.
Cheektowaga?
No.
No. But Notre Dame, they got to have their own freaking network. They're in South Bend. Touchdown, Jesus, yeah. Touchdown, Jesus, my ass, okay? All this
Jesus
nonsense.
Christ.
Yeah, screw him. Slots and stadium in tax bill mix. Now, this is from the Herald, so there might be a little bit of truth in it. You never know. The Florida House of Representatives, which has consistently killed efforts to expand gambling in the state, suddenly resurrected a committee yesterday for just one vote to allow slot machines at 10 racetracks and highlife frontons, including 4 in Dade County.
Oh, my God.
Oh, the sky is falling. The sky is falling. Where's fat-ass Jeb Bush when we need him? Comunista, comunista. Let's get on those no-speaking English stations right away and make sure we put in the kibosh on this. The stated rationale for the change of mind, tax revenue from gambling would help cut property taxes. All right. The other less public reason, a stadium for the Florida Marlins. The deal would work like this. It says, the House hates gambling but wants to give a $60 million subsidy to the Marlins to build a retractable roof stadium. The Senate doesn't care for the Marlins stadium but has already voted to allow pari-mutuels throughout the state to put in slot machines. So each chamber would hold its nose to pass a bill it dislikes to get something that it badly wants. House leaders denied yesterday there's any direct link between the gambling bill and the Marlins measure, but the sponsors are hopeful that since the gambling money would be steered to property tax cuts, both will survive. It appears to me that there's a desire on the part of leaders of both chambers to give each issue a vote, said Senator Steve Geller, the Senate Democratic leader and sponsor of the slots bill. He added that the extra revenue from gaming would make the cost of the Marlins bill, $2 million for 30 years, easier to stomach. You hold your nose, you look the other way, and you puke your guts out. You start gagging like that. The House sponsor, Representative David Rivera, Miami Republican, said he'd be appreciative if his push to bring the gambling bill to a vote provokes a Senate vote on the Marlins. And Senate Republican leader Dan Webster, a Winter Garden Republican, last week vowed that the Marlins bill won't come to a vote in his chamber, gave Monday a noncommittal, we'll see, you know, we'll see, comme si, comme ça, so-so, menza. Were you in Mensa?
No, my
wife. The proposal would allow Calder Racetrack, Flagler Dog Track, Miami High Line, Hialeah Racecourse, and 6 other pari-mutuels around the state to offer slot machines, known in Tallahassee parlance as video lottery terminals, without getting voter approval. Hialeah would first have to reapply for its racing license. Oh, John Brunetti, where are we now that we don't need you no more? Go away, John Brunetti. Put the palm trees back up and get... And they were showing the flamingos on there the other day. What was that I was watching about something about South Florida? And they were showing the flamingos at Hialeah, and I thought to myself, the flamingos are so lonely there, you know? The machines, also called Class 2 or Bingo-style terminals, are identical to the ones now used by the Seminole and Miccosukee Indians at their casinos. They look like Vegas-style slots but produce lower payouts because players, in essence, bet against each other and not against the house. In other words, there's a word that describes those slot machines, ersatz. The House Environment and Natural Resources Council approved the bill 13-1 in an extraordinary late-session meeting convened specially to pass the bill before a friendly committee. The estimated $1 billion that would be raised from these 9 facilities would be sent to school districts across the state, which would then have to reduce property taxes levied to pay for schools. If the plan is approved, taxpayers could see savings about 10 to 20% of the school's portion of their property tax bill. What's not to like? It's a tax cut, said the council's chairman, Representative Stan Mayfield, a Vero Beach Republican. Governor Charlie
Gay.
Crist said Monday she's been told of the House proposal, but is withholding judgment until she sees final version of the bill. I want the legislature to finish his job, she said. Then our lawyers will review the bill. We'll take a position. Oh, yeah. Wouldn't be the first time Governor Crist took a position, you know what I mean?
Gay.
Oh! Yeah, you know what position I'm talking about.
No, what? Tell me.
Well, use your imagination. It was just my imagination. The deal is loaded with political curveballs. House Speaker Marco Rubio, who used to look pretty damn good if you ask me, said he personally will vote against any bill to expand gambling, but added he won't stand in the way of letting it pass through his chamber. Senate President Ken Pruitt's privately pushing for the passage of the slot machines bill and has said he won't stand in the way of a bill to assist the Marlins. It's a little teat for tat. See, I have to change that first word there because we sure as hell can't say that. And right. Rivera, who's one of Rubio's closest lieutenants, personally supports gambling and is being courted by Dade gambling interests who want to conduct a voter referendum next year to bring Vegas-style slot machines to county fair mutuals next year, which they should have done when Broward did it a million moons ago, except for the fact that your fat-ass governor came down there and talked all the Julios into voting against it because the world would come to an end if we had those one-armed bandits. Slot machines, gambling is evil, but a beep, bada boop, bada bop. Yeah, right. You're evil, Jeb, you fat-ass loser phony. But the conservative House is hostile territory for gambling measures. There's no guarantee the slots bill will pass, it says here. A more routine bill to loosen slots regulations is borrowed from mutuals by expanding the number and hours of operation of slot machines and allowing them to put ATMs in their property. Barely passed a vote on Monday, 61-52. Rivera said the vote sent a signal that his bill will have trouble. It certainly has challenges, he said. There's no assurance the Senate will agree with the House proposal. The Senate version would allow all 25 pari-mutuals in the state to expand to Class 2 slots and generate an estimated $1.9 billion in tax revenue a year. The House plan limits the new slots games to pari-mutuals in counties with populations of over 800,000 or within 40 miles of an existing casino operated by the Indians. The bill prohibits Broward County pari-mutuals from offering the machines unless they give up the Vegas-style Class 3 gaming devices they now use, which there are two chances of that happening, much, much less than none, and infinity minus. Some legislators complained Monday the issue was rushed through. I just found out about this, said Representative Rich Glorioso, a Plant City Republican. I don't like this bill, but I'm going to let it go to the floor because I don't believe in anything this large and this magnitude needs to be decided by, he believes it, the entire chamber. But a beep, but a boop, but a bop. And as usual, Florida, they continue diddling around, dragging their heels. Can't do it right. They got to do it the Florida way, man. They got to do it all screwed up. Not the right way, the Florida effing way. Screwed up big time. It's the only way they know how in Florida. And you want to know why? I'll tell you why without even asking, because Florida basically is...
Crap.
That's it. Ever been over to Clearwater? Ever been to Lutz?
Yes.
Ever
no.
been to... Huh?
No.
Well, good. Ever been to Temple Terrace? I've been
no.
to Temple. I've been to my bar mitzvah temple, Temple Beth El in Rochester. Let me say it again. I'm going to die at Strong Memorial Hospital in Rochester, New York.
All right, got it all worked out?
Yeah, I'm leaving right now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go down to Lake Ontario. I'm going to go to the beach, and I'm going to swim across, and then I'm going to croak... And they're going to take my body and stick it right in Strong Memorial, where I was born and I die in the same. Wouldn't that be great? Not.
Not. Yeah.
Why are people so into things like that? You know, everybody wants to know where they came from, their family tree, their roots. Well, why? What difference does it make?
Why not?
No. The question is not why not.
It's better than knowing harness drivers from 50 years ago.
It's better knowing what?
Harness drivers from 50 years ago.
Are you knocking Ray Stein now just because he never left the gate in his life?
Who?
Elmer Conrad. Harold Snodgrass. Harold Fisher. Francis O'Hare. You better not knock Francis O'Hare, man. That old man could drive one. I cashed a lot of tickets on old Frank O'Hare from Flushing, Michigan, baby. Flushing, Michigan. It's like when you go to Woodbine. That's what you're doing with your money. Flushing. Down the turlet. They do have nice turlets over there with them. 1,090 votes on our very marginal poll. Do I really want to read this result or not? I don't know. I just you can always tell that you don't like the poll and you don't want to read the result. You have to motivate yourself. And in this case, I think I'll pass.
This is Brady Quinn. Whenever I shave my balls, I listen to the Neil Rogers 12 to 1 Hour.
Rectum.
Oh! I'm Brady now. I want some Quinn. You ain't seen no man quite like Brady Quinn. La, 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 la.
it for pay and do a solid wall of meat.
Oh!
The kind of guy that I want to do that's good enough to eat.
Absolutely.
I wonder if he'll go on a day, but there's no chance at all. So does that make me a sports queer if I want to see him grab the balls?
Yes.
Oh, baby, wow. Look at that kid. You ain't seen no man quite like Brady Quinn. I got a high-def TV screen that helps me see his buns. I can do all I wanna, but I ain't gonna never get none. Notre Dame's up a visit school, okay, that's not so great. But I'm gushing over him madly,
at least until he's 28.
I'm Brady now, I want some Quinn. You ain't seen no man quite like Brady Quinn. Oh, baby, wow. Look at that kid. You ain't seen no man quite like Brady Quinn.
Okay, what do we got? We got 1,100 votes on there, or what? Chris, what does it say? It says 1,102. 1102. And what did I say we needed today we're going to get?
You said 1250.
I think we can do 13. What do you think, George? Can we go for 13 today? What do you say? Yeah, what do you think?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes! Yeah!
All right. Let's go for 1300. If we don't get it, then Chris loses his job. What?
Ouch.
You know, if his face was capable of changing expression, he might have actually looked sad there.
I think during this next break, I'm going to make me some lunch.
Okay.
I'm going to make me a couple of them nice wieners I got, the ones that are not loaded with nitrates and nitrites and cancer-causing chemicals and all of these horrible
things. All of these things.
1102 on the poll. If you don't know what the poll is, too bad, because I'm not going to read it for a long time. Maybe till the end of the show. And I don't like it. Well, if you don't like it, why did you put it on there? You know something? Can I give you an honest answer?
Okay, because you wanted to?
No, because I'm lazy. Because it was toward the top of the pile of polls I got here. Seriously, you know how many polls you fax me from Charlie B. and from other people, but mostly from him, all the time. Well, now, here's an interesting, let's see. This is a poll I found in the middle of my pile. It's not from Charlie B. It's from some other goofball. It says, how would you describe your sexual orientation on a scale from 1 to 6, where 1 is completely straight and 6 is completely, it says full-on straight. Well, what is full-on? Completely straight and 6 is full on.
We, those of us who are straight, call that straight.
Oh, are we going to do this again?
Well,
are
you
we
insist. Are
we going to do this again?
There's a such thing as straight people.
I can't stand it.
I know. It's a switchful thinking.
I'm just reading the poll. I don't care what you think about it.
You asked a question. What does that mean, full on straight?
I'm not interested. I don't ask, okay?
Uh-huh.
I'm not interested what number they are on a scale. The only number I care about is what number they are on my own personal Richter scale.
Yeah.
That's the number I care about. If I see a good number, all right. I'm a pervert. That's all. I'm proud of it. Then they got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It varies by the day. It varies by the hour. I'm not really sure. I'm asexual. I'm a Catholic priest or none. Well, so we know it's a 6. Or I hate this poll. No, we don't do I hate this poll no more. Well, anyway, that was just in the middle of the pile. The Florida legislature today changed the state's 34-year-old rental laws to allow thousands of dollars in new penalties against renters who break their leases, giving landlords changes they've been seeking for 3 years. Renters who break the... And, of course, in a transient place like South Florida, people don't break their lease, do they, George?
I don't think so.
The hell they don't.
They don't?
The hell they don't.
I don't.
Well, you don't because you're an upstanding guy.
That's right.
And a sucker.
That's right.
Renters who break their leases would pay a penalty equal to 2 months' rent, face additional costs equal to another month to back any concession such as a free month to pay back. The 2 month rent penalty would apply not only to tenants who leave midway through a rental contract, but those who don't give proper 60-day written notice they're not renewing their leases. Well, excuse me. With virtually no debate, votes on the new penalties were overwhelming, with the Senate unanimously approving the changes and the House by a vote of 101-14. Now the bill goes to Governor Charlie
Gay.
Crist. Hey, Charlie.
You fairy.
The new rules would not apply to current rental leases. Only leases that begin after Ms. Crist signs the legislation and law would be subject to the increased penalties. Well, so what does that mean, you know? That means that all you people that are already renting, you can screw over your landlord and laugh your ass off. That's what that means. Is that what it sounds like it means to you?
Sure.
Under current law, landlords can only charge renters who break their leases for the time it takes to find a new tenant, but they can't overlap payments, referred to by consumer advocates as double rent. The legislature changes allow landlords to collect thousands in penalties, even if they got another tenant already moving immediately, if not sooner. Well, how do you like that? It's called double dripping. 11:60 on the poll. Let's save Chris's job. Let's get that 1,300 by 2 o'clock today. What do you say? Let's see how much the audience likes you, Chris. This is like a referendum on your popularity.
Should I start packing now?
Packing?
Pack them.
Packing what?
11:16, a pistola. Eleven sixteen is what we got right now. I'll tell you, the poll, the substance of it a lot of days like today doesn't make any difference. It's a crappy poll. But it's the numbers, baby. That's what it's all about, those numbers. QAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Crash is bad. I think it was bad.
What?
I think Crash, the movie, was bad.
Oh,
based on
guy.
What? Yeah. What
I think they just tried. They just tried to cram too many little stories into one movie, and it just kind of got like so a six-year-old can understand the theme, you know.
And what was the theme?
Well, the whole racial thing about assuming things about people. It's like Every single little conversation had to do with it.
So what was wrong with that?
It was just too obvious.
It's an excellent point, by the way. It's an outstanding point. It's a very true point. Maybe you can handle that.
It was just a little too obvious.
Your taste blows, man. That's all I can tell you, okay? It's a little too long, and it was a six-year-old. So you didn't like it. We don't really care whether you liked it or not, okay? Anybody with a brain who saw Crash thought it was out-effing standing, okay? Read my stupid-ass old craggy lips. Crash is a great movie.
Right.
Period.
Every story...
It would be like having an argument about The Godfather. It's the same thing. I'm not saying it's as good as The Godfather, but it's, you know...
But then what is?
Yeah, that's correct. But it's certainly like in the top 5 million. What is this guy talking? It's no reincarnation of Peter Proud.
But then what is?
Yeah. Crash was fine. And all the acting performance. I think, you know why he doesn't like it? Same reason they're not upset about Brady Quinn. Too pretty. He doesn't like, what's his name? My boy, that was Ryan Philippe. Philippi, who used to be Ryan Philippe. That's why he don't like it, because that pretty boy was in there. They hate pretty boys. And you want to know why the guys in South Florida hate pretty boys? Because they're jealous. Do you think there's one guy listening to me right now who doesn't wish that he was Brady Quinn? You think there's anybody?
I'll take it.
What about you, Chris? Would you like to be Brady Quinn right now?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Although, you know, going to Cleveland isn't all that's cracked up to me. But nevertheless, WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil. How the hell are you?
Okay, sir.
I wanted to call earlier when you were talking about Crash, and I actually enjoyed the movie very much. I only saw it once, so I need to get it again, but... You said Matt Damon had a part in it?
Matt Dillon.
Oh.
Ah.
Matt Dillon. Like, Matt Damon, what the
not
hell?
Matt Damon.
Oh, Matt Dillon. Matt
not
Dillon.
Alec Baldwin.
I gotcha. Anyway, that's for you. Bye-bye.
Okay. Not Matt Damon. He was in The Talented Mr. Ripley. No, Matt Damon wasn't in it because there was no character that he could play, you know. Although he was good, I'll give him credit though. What's that series of movies that he's in? Don't tell me it. Where he's the what is it? The Bourne Identity.
Correct.
Yeah.
The Bourne this, the Bourne that, the Bourne Again Christian. Bourne. Yeah, those are good movies. The Bourne. Yeah. I think I've seen them all.
One out of the rest of them ain't bad.
Well, what does that mean?
I like the Bourne Identity, but the rest of them were kind of weak.
Maybe that's the only one I've seen. It's in the other room. Maybe I'll put it on right now and watch it.
Well, there's only two so far.
Just to be sure. Well, whatever, okay? He does a good job in there. He doesn't play some faggot, okay? All you people. And didn't he just get married to some hot chick? I mean, that looks pretty good. I'm not saying I believe it, but he got married. They married him off. All those stories about him and Ben Affleck, you know what I mean? Come on. Does anybody believe that?
Yes.
Oh. WQAM, hello.
Hi, two calls back, you got some guy on the air that said he hated Crash or whatever.
Yeah.
I totally don't know what he was talking about. That was the funniest movie that I'd seen all year in 2004.
WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil, did you hear the good news about James D. Kennedy?
No.
Well, he is giving up his lobbying firm, the Center for Creationist Government or whatever it was.
Yeah.
And, well, he's recovering from the heart attack in Michigan, so
no,
the Coral Ridge Ministries is like dead.
Oh, good. That's the good news, like I said. Okay, thanks for the good news, sir. See, God smote him, baby. They said, you phony baloney, you virulent anti-Semite, you hate monger, you homophobe, you piece of right-wing phony baloney religious money-grubbing turd, you. And he smote him, whatever that means. Isn't God always smiting and smoting?
He likes to smite.
And spite. He likes to smite and spite.
Out of spite.
Yeah. Sadistic bastard. 1,125 votes on the poll, by the way. Chris's job, his life depends on this, man. We got to get to 1,200 by 1. Then we got a shot for 13. Am I at least right about that? Don't you have to get to 12 before you get to 13? Even Danny Boy can count that out.
Rock solid.
You're gay.
There's a new prescription drug whose name says it all.
Zydefax.
Finally, a prescription medicine that always gives you more than you'd expect.
Zydefax.
Isn't it time you experienced Zydefax?
May cause loss of blood, loss of hearing, loss of virginity, vertigo, impetigo, impotence, imprisonment, shrinkage of the genitals, enlargement of the genitals, softening of the brain, softening of the stool, loose stools, bar stools, toadstools, huge prehistoric bats swooping out of the sky and eating your dog, halitosis, Halle Berry, Berry, Barry Manilow, rectal bleeding, rectal numbness, numb nuts, chest pains, hunger pains, dry mouth, cotton mouth, large mouth, small mouth, hell mouth, or death.
Zydefax is perfect for everyone.
Not intended for women who are pregnant, women who are men, men who are pregnant, children with dogs who are pregnant, the elderly, the young, kitty cats, Steve Perry, tadpoles, tadpoles who are pregnant, and pregnant pauses. In disclaimers like these.
Ask your doctor or pharmacist about Zydefax and find out if it's responsible for the mysterious pustulant growth under your left armpit.
Which reminds me that I just went to the kitchen. In fact, it's in the flavor wave right now, my lunch.
What?
Oh. Part of my lunch. And I put a wiener on there, you know?
Yeah.
A beef wiener. And I took it out of the package and it had like a genital wart on it.
Growth under your armpit?
No, on the wiener.
Oh. I see.
And it kind of like took me aback for a second there. Like before I lifted up, you know how you lift up the top of the flavor mm-hmm. wave? And you slip whatever. And I, you know, I bit that thing off of there before I put it in the thing. I didn't want to cook it. You don't want to cook a genital wart.
No, you don't.
So anyway, as soon as I hear that beep, beep, that from the, then I'm going to get up out of here and then you can like play your music for a second.
Okay.
Well, no, because I got my plate ready. I sliced up a few onions. I got my French's mustard here. Now, you don't dislike French's, do you? Is that made by Kraft? I'm sure it's not.
I don't know. They're fine.
Well, let's see who makes it.
Kraft makes everything, man.
No, they do not make French's mustard.
Good.
Okay.
Good. All right, there's one.
Jesus, it's FrenchFoods.com. Okay, it's got nothing to do with Kraft or crap or anything like that.
Thank God.
As a matter of fact, imported by Reckitt Benckiser, Canada, Toronto, Ontario, eh? Well, good. At least it didn't come from, like, Bangladesh or some damn 18th world place like that, or like Connecticut. 11:38 on the poll. They're coming in chunks for you now, Chris. I think they're going to come through for you. Or maybe not.
We'll see.
Huh?
We'll see. It's still
Cordis,
early.
Cordis sent me an email. He said he's all ready to come back in and take over again. If you don't get to 1,300, we got 11:38. Well, let's do the math on this. And I hate that expression. Like, so Pusher, we didn't see, huh? How about Chris? Did you see Pusher?
No.
And I keep forgetting the IMDb. Well, I got to get that wiener out of there. So we got 60 and 42 is 102 minutes, and we need 162. Oh, we should be able to do that. That's less than two. The usual ratio is if it's less than 2 minutes, we can do it on this show. And of course, this audience, you know. Which I notice they're not calling now, which is probably a really good sign. Well, Crash was the funniest movie. Ah, yeah. Crash and Burn, that's what we say to you, okay? Crash and Burn, you lunatics, you losers, you sad excuses. You know, could there possibly be any place more parochial on the face of the earth than South Florida?
There is. I haven't been there.
That's the thing that kills me. And we keep hearing about, well, it's a melting pot. It's all these people from all these other places. Well, that's the amazing part of it is because I guess they forgot where the other places were except maybe New York, you know, because everything was better in New York. You can have New York. That's what I would suggest. You know the last time I was in New York, you know how many years ago that was?
I don't know, 100?
It's just not on my list. I wouldn't mind going back to Boston or Chicago. I'm also not going back to Detroit for reasons that are too obvious to even mention. You know, it's a toilet. Toilet. If I want to go to the toilet, I got two of them right here in my apartment. Got a little one, and I got a big one in there with one of those big. Do people actually ever use those?
Those what?
Those tubs that have got the, what do you call those? The jets?
The bidet?
No, not a bidet, a tub.
Oh, like a whirlpool, like a massage kind of thing?
Yeah, not a whirlpool.
I guess.
Like, you know what I'm talking about.
Old arthritic people,
I'm old, but I'm not arthritic. Knock on wood. I'm doing pretty good, to be honest with you, for a regular old car.
No creaky bones?
Oh, guess what? Beep, beep. Okay, play. Do something. Talk for a minute. Just a second.
I'm going to talk for a minute. What the hell am I going to talk about? How's a girlfriend coming on, Chris?
Pretty good.
That's good.
What about you?
I'm doing all right.
How long does it take him to go to the kitchen?
He's right there. He's coming back.
Right here. What's wrong with you? Were you going in the kitchen?
Yeah.
What is this called? Sympathetic eating now? Because I got a wiener here with a couple little slices of onion?
Hey, any excuse. You know how you fat people roll.
So one thing about fat people, we're always either eating something or drinking something. Have you ever noticed that? Fat people always have something in their mouth. Well, no, it's true. I admit it. I've noticed that about fat people. They're always drinking something, and usually it's got sugar in it and some crap, too. It's not like a diet soda. Now, let's see how this wiener came out. I got my mouse turd, my onion. Mmm. Man, that's good. Mmm.
Let me keep playing some music.
No. So well, why the hell can't they listen to me chew on air for crying out loud, huh?
Why not?
When in doubt, chew them out. You could be adding a little something here or not.
I could, but...
Well, love.
I just don't feel like it.
Why not?
I got nothing to say.
You like it?
I got nothing to say at the moment.
You got nothing to say?
No. I didn't prepare anything.
So, in other words, unless you prepare something, you have nothing to say?
Well, I mean, I could pull something out of my arse.
I'll bet. With a rope.
Mm-hmm.
11:43, Chris. How are you feeling? You feeling confident?
Yeah, I will get it.
A little shaky? A little nervous? I would be. Because if it gets to be like about 11:90, and we have about 5 minutes to go, you know damn well that they're going to stick it to you. You know this crowd, don't you? They're relentless.
Yep.
And they hate you, too.
They hate everybody. They hate each other. They hate themselves.
That's right.
They hate life. They hate the taste of the air.
But I will say this. The poll people come through for us, Dahl, every time.
Yeah, they do.
So obviously the poll people and the callers are not the same. The poll people are the online people.
Right.
Who are the good people. Some of them.
Some of them. Most
like,
of them.
Like the Serbian Stallion and his wife. I wonder if she has a name.
Probably.
Yeah, and I'm sure most of you guys would like to find out what it is, too. Besides honey.
Honey pie.
Sugar pie, honey bunch. Oh, I could play that.
So could I.
While I'm eating this wiener. Yeah. Instead of making all these guttural sounds like a pig eating on the air. Like some kind of fat swallow. They're not paying you all that money to eat on the air, you old fat faggot. They're not paying you money to eat. You're supposed to be entertaining us. And amusing us. And saving the world from itself and regaling us with wild stories. How do you like that? Even with a mouthful of wiener there, I could do the talk up just perfect. Wasn't that good?
That was great.
Don't forget to call Rick Strong in a few days.
I will. Forget.
I'm going to send him a message later today. He's one of our MySpace friends, you know.
Well, good.
You didn't know that?
No, I don't look at, even though I'm looking right now.
You don't look at what?
I haven't really spent that much time on it after the initial, novelty.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I answer the messages every other day, every 3 days, whatever it is.
Now, what about on our show page here? Have you seen the comments today by the Serbian Stallion?
No.
One of which didn't come out.
No.
And you could click on him and take a look at him and his lovely young wife. He's 18. I don't know how old she is.
Let me do that
They're
now.
Young punks, huh?
Let me do that now.
Yeah, I bet you will. As soon as I said take a look at his wife, right away he's going to do it right now. Mm-hmm. Right under the Howard Dean posting on there. You see where the comments are down there?
I will when it loads up.
He has a wife, you know.
Mm-hmm. Kind of a cute couple, if you ask me. For all you swingers out there, I'm just, you know, thinking out loud. I'm sure they're not interested, but nevertheless. Have you finally got on the page or what?
Yeah, I'm on the page. I'm scrolling. There he is.
And?
And I'm on his page.
You click the pic? Click where it says pics. Man, that was good.
Looking for the wife.
That's his little cutesy wife. You don't think she's cute?
Where? I don't see her. Oh, there. I see that first picture.
Yeah.
She's very cute.
See, I told you.
She'll do.
And so will he. She's not nearly as pretty as he is, but then again...
That's
there,
not
there
true.
Are those, there are those situations. She's not nearly, not yeah. even close
well,
to being as pretty as
you're
he
You're wrong,
is.
Of course, as usual.
He's 100 times prettier than she'll ever be.
Yeah, that's those gay as cataracts
in,
that...
As in pretty good. And why does he, in so many of those photos on there, always have his mouth open wide like that? Well, maybe he wants to get fed. I don't know. 11:52 on the poll, Chris. Now, the first race is to get to 1,200. We need 48 votes in 34 minutes this hour to get to 1,200. I think you're in big trouble.
Increíble.
Increíble.
Back in the day when someone done us wrong, we didn't take their crap. In Pearl Harbor, when the Japs dropped their bombs, we bombed them back. And now the Saudis, they hit us hard. And on our cards, our little flags wave. As that Saudi loving retard points the bombers the wrong way.
Oh my God.
And I'm embarrassed to be an American. Where they follow Bush like sheep. The United States of arrogance, led by Bush and his family greed. They got this country. And the link towards the darkest days in our history. I don't want to be a Pax American in the USA. What's a few thousand innocent lives? Stop living in the past. If you want that SUV to drive, you're gonna need more gas. It's the greatest country in the world. They train us to believe. And anyone who says that, obviously, can't afford to leave.
I'm dying over here.
And I'm embarrassed to be an American, where we patriotically wave a flag in one hand with our head in the sand and blindly follow the powers that be. Apathetic, watching State Front News on a 65-inch screen. Scratch your fart, everything's okay. In the USA.
You know, something just dawned on me in that last break for the 80 millionth time of those Marlins promos and all the other airtime that we take with the Marlins and the Panthers and the this and the that. And after this, well, the Panther season's already over, you know. How are they doing in the playoffs? Any playoff games?
No.
And so the fact is that we're getting rid of the Marlins and the Panthers, and look at all the energy that was put in there. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And all the airtime and all the wasted...
Well, those are all labors of love, you know.
All the money, yeah, labors of love and labors of losing money. Losing money like crazy, like the Marlins. Oh, my God. And, speaking of the Panthers, something also just dawned on me.
Ow!
If the Panthers are going to another station after this last season just ended, who's going to be... where's he going to be?
Ow!
Who's going to put him on, huh? Is he going to continue being the voice of the Panthers? I think the team hires the announcers, don't they, Chris?
Say that one more time. I'm talking to your boy.
You're talking to my boy?
Yeah, he just walked in here and needed a change.
He needed a change for 100 now that he's rich.
Oh, my little boy? Josh? Hey, Josh, did you cash that check?
He said yesterday, as I told you before.
It hasn't gone through on her yet. Maybe it bounced. But anyway, yeah, they'll probably want you to come back in.
What was about the announcers?
Aren't they selected by the teams?
That would be correct.
Well, so, Geldy... If they select him, are we going to be carrying the... Well, we're not carrying the Panther games anyway. That's my point. So if another station carries the Panther games, maybe we can unload him. I mean, I didn't mean to put it in those terms. Maybe we can dump his squeaky ass at the same time.
Well, if he's going to keep doing the Panthers, then yeah, that would happen.
That would happen. Oh, wouldn't that be a shame? Because I see he's on tomorrow after the early Marlin game, from after the game until 7, and then he's going to be on again on Thursday, Geldy at the Dolphins Award Banquet, squeaking his way to success. Won't that be something if we lost Geldy? Jesus, God Almighty, how would we survive? Isn't it something how I can see? I see ahead. I close my eyes and I see ahead. WQAM, hello.
One note, Charlie.
WQAM, hello.
This is Goldie on the Dolphins Radio Network. How's that?
5670560. Come on, let's not be picking on Geldy now that he's going to be moving on, I guess. Yeah, I wonder what Moe, his old sidekick, would think about that. Probably like to kick him in the side or in a few other spots as well. Those two, man, you talk about a great hate. They grew to hate each other. Every time I'd be in the building, which wasn't very often toward the latter stages there, I'd be coming out of the tea room and there'd be Geldy. Oh, my God, I don't know how I can put up with any more of this. I can't stand it. Oh, that old man, blah, 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 blah. Just carrying on like a moron, you know, like a maniac. 1172 on the poll, Chris. We need 28 votes this hour to get up to 12, and that's in 24 minutes. Oh, I think you might make it.
Yeah, we got it.
Yeah, don't get too complacent now, man. You should know this crowd better than that.
They feel sorry for me.
No, they don't. I hate you like poison. QAM.
Just received a message.
Mm-hmm. WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
How much longer are you going to read that Mercedes-Benz?
As long as it's on, man. As long as they pay me to do it. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Kelly.
WQAM, hello.
Yo.
Yo.
What I do?
WQAM, hello.
Yes, Neil.
Yes, sir.
You pushed a button, and I thought we talked about that. You
pushed
the original gay button.
Oh, yeah. WQAM, hello.
Neil?
Yes.
Hi. Listen, yesterday a guy called you, and he goes, oh, yeah, I want to take my wife to the Brady practice. And I think the biggest dude on the planet. I mean, I think the guy wanted to watch Brady Quinn practice.
No, there's no question about that. Yeah. Who wouldn't want to watch him practice?
Me?
All depending on what he was practicing.
Me?
As long as he doesn't bring that blonde. Oh, my God.
She was nasty.
Really?
Well, congratulations. Well, I heard Mandage say something yesterday about his hot girlfriend. He must have left her home.
Hot girlfriend? Jesus Christ. I'm not gay, but I'd rather do Brady than that girl.
Amen. Later, man. There you go. Now, there's one situation where George can't argue with me because you didn't see it anyway.
What?
But if Brady Quinn's not a lot prettier than that blonde chick they had in there, claiming that she was his girlfriend.
I didn't see it, so.
Well, even Chris would have to agree with that.
Okay.
Grudgingly.
He wasn't paying that much attention to her. I mean,
grudgingly.
I was grudgingly,
he would have to admit to that. Otherwise, we might have to cut off the vote right now on that poll.
Just play along, man. It'll be easier for you.
1174. Yeah, just pretend you agree, okay?
I agree.
That's George's attitude, because there are no pretty guys. No pretty guys. There's only pretty women, you know, and there's some pretty ugly women.
Pretty boys.
There are pretty boys out there.
Pretty mouths.
Pretty, that's right, like the Serbian stallion, whatever his name is.
His wife is much prettier than him.
QAM. No, she's not.
Yes, she is.
Hello.
How you doing, Neil?
Okay.
Hey, I got a question for you. You know, Paul and Ron show, they extended their hours to where they're on until noon now?
Yeah, they're on 1,500 hours a day, yeah.
How does the book come out for that now? They're not in a four-hour block
anymore.
Well,
how does the book come out for that? They've been doing that for a week, for
right.
a few days.
Well, yeah, but they said they signed a new contract, then that's in the
new contract.
You know
something? They could be on 40 hours a day, and they still suck. That's my answer to you. You know, they're still ripping off everybody else's material, including mine, and they could be on 80 hours a day. It's the dumbest programming decision I've ever heard of in my life, except, of course, most of the ones that are made on the station. Pretty stupid, man, all you people at Cheap Channel. Good God. Let's have Paul and Ron on from 5:30 in the morning till 5 in the afternoon. All right. WQAM, hello. QAM, hello.
Neil, I was looking at your Wikipedia. It says that you died yesterday. What's up?
Yeah, good. Okay, good. WQAM, hello.
Hello, Nels?
Yeah.
This is Mike Ranieri calling for again.
WQAM, hello.
Neil, how you doing?
Okay.
I'm a Dolphins fan, but I didn't watch the draft, and who knows what the heck's going to go on. But I thought you would like the quarterback because he's Mormon, and I know you like more men than less.
Now, what's up with your guy from Ashboka?
Way down in Jamaica in the Caribbean, they got the best herb that you ever seen. Ask anybody in that neighborhood, they tell you this the country where the ganja be good. Rasta man has some he want to sell, and from a mile away you can detect the smell of smoke. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. He light up the spliff and talk. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. The ganja be good. You can carry lots of herb in the gunny sack. Smoke it every day until your lungs turn black. With all the money that we have made, Jamaica doesn't need any foreign aid. American tourists come here and say, got nothing like this in the USA. They smoke, smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. They light up the spliff and talk. They begin to cough and choke. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke.
Huh?
The ganja be good. Mama tell her son you are a Rasta man. You like to smoke the giant spliff whenever you can. Many people coming here from miles around to buy the herb for you by the ounce and the pound. Rasta man say to her, Mama, you're right. The ganja be good tonight. And then they smoke. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. They light up the spliff and talk. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. Smoke, ganja, smoke, smoke. Ganja be good.
All right.
Yeah, man.
1188, I think Chris is going to eat this one out. I think you're going to squeak on through, okay?
We're going to do it.
I never really thought we'd make 13 today. Did you? I never thunk it.
That's why I said it.
1188. So we need 12 more in 13 minutes this hour to get 1,200. And you got to get to 12, and then you might get to 13. Then you might get to 14, and you might get to first base. But I sure doubt it, not when you look at this.
In a short period of time.
Oh, my God. It is scary. Brian Ross of ABC News reported last night on the mounting scandal from the records of the so-called D.C. madam, una prostituta. Ross said many prominent D.C. figures can be found on the list of clients for the escort service, which has emerged in the course of the trial of its operator, Deborah Jean Palfrey. It's a long list. We've been going through the phone records for the last 4 years provided us by Jean Palfrey, Ross reported on Monday morning. There are some very prominent people, lobbyists, lawyers, members of the military, other people in the Bush administration. Not right-wing hypocrites, finger-pointing people. That couldn't be, could it?
No.
Bunch of phonies. Palfrey, 50, dubbed the D.C. madam in local media, which has been arraigned in federal court on charges of operating Washington prostitution service for 13 years until her retirement in 2006. Palfrey's denied she ran a prostitution ring. Her company, Pamela Martin and Associates, was simply a high-end adult fantasy firm which offered legal, sexual, and erotic services across the spectrum of adult sexual behavior and did so without incident during its 13-year tenure, she said. Boy, sounds like a lot of linguistics there to me. Offered legal, sexual, and erotic services across the spectrum of adult sexual behavior.
Yeah, what's wrong with that?
Nothing. Palfrey contends her escort service provided university-educated women to engage in legal game-playing of a sexual nature at $275 an hour for a 90-minute session, the Washington Post reports. Legal game-playing of a sexual nature. But Palfrey has also hinted that she has a record of the phone numbers of thousands of more than 10,000 customers that could embarrass more than a few of the U.S. Capitol's high flyers. Friday, the U.S. State Department announced that Randall Tobias, the embattled head of the U.S. Agency for International Development, was resigning for unspecified personal reasons. However, ABC News, which said Palfrey had provided it with a record of numbers of calls to his private cell phone, reported that Tobias stepped down after they spoke to him about his allegedly contacting her number. Her number. Since maybe she hooked him up with a good number. Since 2003, Tobias has also been President Bush's first global AIDS coordinator, a job where he drew criticism for his emphasis on faithfulness to partners and abstinence over condom use in trying to prevent the spread of the AIDS virus. Before entering government, he was chairman, president, and chief executive of the pharmaceutical giant Eli Lilly. Oh, my God, a bunch of butchers if there ever were any. Remember thalidomide?
Oh, yeah.
Babies being born with 18 heads, little things like that. And also from 1997 to 2000, chairman of the board of trustees at Duke University, the Humper's alma mater, no less. His now reported links to a firm accused of prostitution have raised more than a few eyebrows, just like that Saturday draft pick by your Dolphins raised more than a few eyebrows. I bet you even Randy Rooney was like pushing him around. Palfrey's California home and other assets were seized by U.S. tax authorities in October, and Palfrey's been trying to raise funds for her defense through an appeal on her website. Her lawyer, Montgomery Blair Sibley, told Fox TV last month, the statistical certainty is that there are a fair number of high-profile people who have used this service across the government and private sector in the metropolitan D.C. area. And the Post reported Saturday that local jitters appear to be multiplying. It said Sibley claimed that he's been contacted in the past few days and has been contacted by five lawyers asking whether their clients' phone numbers are on Palfrey's list of 10,000 to 15,000 customers from 2002 to 2006. That may have something to do with the fact that Palfrey already has named her first name, as it were, on her website, where she's posted a court document from April 12th in which she alleges former U.S. Navy Commander Harlan Ullman was a regular customer whom she needs to subpoena. Wouldn't be the first time, I'm sure. With James Wade, Ullman developed a military doctrine of shock and awe used by...
Aw.
Aw, shucks. Woo! Used by U.S. government in its invasion of Iraq. According to one definition, that is shorthand for rapid dominance based on the use of overwhelming decisive force, dominant maneuvers, and spectacular displays of power to subdue the other side. Earlier this month, Ullman told CNN, the allegations don't dignify a response and referred any other questions to his lawyer. Shock and awe my ass, Harlan.
That's easy to do.
Yeah, that's shock and awe, all right. Wow. 1191, do you think we're going to get to 1200 by, we got 8 minutes for 9 votes. Ought to be a piece of cake, shouldn't it? In fact, if I click that view current thing, there's the currents. Man, they're good on ice cream, too, by the way. 1192, we need 8 votes in 8 minutes. Now, where would you buy currents? Do they sell them, like, in the market?
I imagine.
Yeah, they sell them at Publix.
They do?
Yep.
They sell currents at Publix?
Chris ought to know.
That's what I said.
Why would Chris know?
He's a fat eater.
I used to work there.
You used to work at Publix? You're like a bag boy?
No, it's a stockman.
Oh, thank God for that, because I was going to say, if the quality of bag boys has degenerated to that level, I mean, I don't want to make a personal shot, but you know, all those Publix bag boys, where is that bit?
It's in there.
Oh, I know.
Happy 12th anniversary from the bag boys at Publix.
Okay.
Happy 12th anniversary, Neil. Yeah, I'm a bag boy. My name's Jason.
Right. Oh, do you know how many years ago? That's 19 years ago. Those guys are married with kids now. Or I'm not too sure about a couple of them.
Not that first one, no.
Yeah, well, come on. Now, that's bad. What are you implying?
Gay.
Just because you know, kids have high, squeaky voices. Maybe he was, you know,
was,
a ridgeling.
Awfully
maybe he only
lispy.
Had one descended testicle, man. What
wasn't
do you know?
The pitch of his voice.
Yeah, the pitch. The swish of his voice?
Yeah.
Don't listen to him, whoever you are. 1195. Whatever happened to those people, by the way? You know, see, that's all in the past. 1195. We'll get to 1200 by one. That's a given, Chris. You got that. You need 5 votes in 7 minutes. Anybody could do that. Even Dan LeBastard could do that.
I'm not sure about that.
You know, see, let me say this to you. I think we got 1,352 MySpace friends, and they're all real people, or at least people who pretend to be real people. We don't have any fake people that we put on there as fake. He's got 17, I noticed on his website the other day, he's got 1,700 people, and I think about 800 or 900 of them are like, Jimmy Syphilis, fake Hank Goldberg, fake Eddie Kay, fake this one. You know, we don't have no fake Boob Shambi on there, or no fake Stu Gatz. Why would you want to have a fake Stu Gatz? Who the hell wants the real one when you come right down to it? I mean, that whole concept that a bunch of little children, it would be like Robert Grieper, general manager of WQAM, they're like that, you know? Now, did Kenny finally stop saying that? Because I might actually listen again if I'm sure he won't say that.
I'll go find somebody that knows.
Robert Grieper, the Lord of the Board, what was the other part of that?
I don't know.
You forgot
Robert
the Grim Reaper.
Robert Grieper, the Grim Reaper, the Lord of the board. Oh, God. As soon as I heard him say that, I said to myself, this show is doomed to fail, Kenny, with all due respect, you know. Doomed to fail. Doomed to a miserable death. I don't know about that. I hear rumors. Don't you hear rumors up and down the hallway?
All the time.
Buzzing, bzz, bzz. Aren't they doing that? Maybe that's about the draft Saturday, not about that morning show. Bzz. 1201, Chris, you're on your way, baby. You're on your way to San Jose. I think you, every day we're going to put you through this. And you know what? Then you'll lose weight. That's called, although I don't know about you, do you do stress eating?
Not really, no. I don't think so.
You don't?
I know I used to, but I'm trying not to do it anymore. So
well, that's good. Well, now that you got this great job at these at this kind of a price, you know, at this kind of salary, what stress could you possibly be
this
under?
This kind of what?
At this kind of cash. In addition to which, you know, you can't afford to, I mean, how can you afford to overeat anyway? Who can afford to buy the food?
Exactly.
Maybe that's why he knows how the price of currants at Publix.
I never said I bought them. I just know they have them.
They're good for you. They're good for you, and they're pretty, I mean, they're small. So I guess if you bought like 10,000 of them, you can make like a little bowl of them with like some sugar and cream would be good. Maybe. Oh, and you know what they're really good on? Ice cream. Mmm. 12. Didn't I tell you that before, George?
Yep. Yes, you did.
That's what I had in Copenhagen. As long as I live, I don't remember how many years ago that is. It's about probably, oh, I don't know, 13, 14, 15 years ago. As long as I live, I'll never forget that hotel, that restaurant, and the blonde waiter that waited on us. Oh, my God. But anyway, guy, that's a guy. I guess you figured that out.
Yeah.
This is Brady Quinn. I like to shave my legs, arms, and buns while listening to the Neil Rogers 1 to 2 Hour.
You wanted more, and you got it. The Mad Dog is back, singing more duets on Bandit Sings, Volume 2.
Yes!
Old number 88 is back, pairing off with the greats, singing more big hits with even more big stars. The Mad Dog does them all. It's an all-new British Invasion with the Mad Dog singing like a man.
I like it. I like it.
The truth is finally out that Jim Mandich was truly the fifth Beatle.
You gotta give me little lovin', give me little lovin'.
Oh!
If you want our love to last. Now you're here to stay. You'll always hear me say it's gonna be alright.
Hear the Mad Dog's tender and touching tribute to the king. Elvis.
Alright! Alright!
Dog was just a little ambivalent when we asked him if he wanted to do it again.
Nah, I don't think so.
So we had Luca Brasi pay him a little visit and tell him either his brains or his signature would wind up on the contract.
That son of a bitch was huge.
All right. All right. All right. All right.
And it sings. Volume 2, available now if you move quickly.
All right. 103 at 560, that business if you move quickly, that's from the Steve Kane School of BS. Remember those days?
Yes.
We have an open line. We have one open line if you move quickly. And you look at the phone,
yeah.
There'll be no calls on there. But that was his way of psyching the audience into calling. He psyched them. You know, it's the psychological ploy, you know. If you move real fast, you might get in. And now he's, a born-again Christian on a station that nobody knows the call letters of, that nobody knows where to find on the dial. But everybody's got to make a living, baby. Mosque 11, as they say in China. 1,218 votes on the poll, or 1,216, excuse me. I don't want to exaggerate now. I'm not trying to push it here for Chris. 1,218, like I just predicted. 1,218. And I'll actually read the, I hate this poll. An estimated 900,000 Floridians drive our roads with suspended licenses. Your response? Question mark. Confiscate their vehicles, 292. Throw their arses in jail, 241. As an ass. Throw their asses in jail, 241. What do you expect from third world drivers, 224? I bet most of them are here in South Florida, 185. How negative and how true. Just shoot them, 125. Fine them and slap them on the wrist, 54. Revoke their licenses permanently, 51. And I'm one of them, 46. And we're going to hunt your ass down. All 46 of you, we're going to hunt you down all over town. And we're going to throw you out there in the middle of I-95 and in the middle of, not rush hour, like at 2 in the morning when everybody's going 100 miles an hour. So what do you think, Chris? What do you think your chances are of keeping your job? You need 82 votes in 55 minutes.
We got it.
Now, that's less than 2 minutes by far, but nevertheless, it's still 82 votes. It's a long way to Tipperary, baby. And I keep 1220. Now you need 80. I'm almost tempted to just go, just keep refreshing that, baby, or keep clicking that thing between now and 2 o'clock, which sure kill a good hour.
Watch pot never boils. I beg to differ.
What the hell does that mean?
It does burn, though.
You guys with your pot. David Korn writes, in new book, Tenet bashes Cheney belatedly. Should Americans have to pay to get the truth about how their government failed them? Former CIA director George Tenet's new book has hit the bookstores for $30.
About 30, man.
A reader can find out what really happened in that December 2002 meeting at the White House when Tenet used the phrase slam dunk, or what really happened with the pre-war WMD intelligence and how it was used or abused by George W. Bush, Dick Cheney, and others. The usual promotional theatrics are underway. Tenet appeared on 60 Minutes on Sunday, and CBS had already released some choice tidbits of that interview. Meanwhile, the New York Times last week got a copy of the Under Wraps book and reported some of its disclosures. Newsflash, Cheney pushed the nation to war without ever seriously examining the threat posed by Iraq. All of this was making Tenet, the man who was in charge of an intelligence establishment that failed the country before 9/11 and that then produced an intelligence estimate that vastly overstated the WMD threat posed by Iraq, a rich fellow. He reportedly bagged millions of dollars for writing this book. Oh, gag me with a spoon. But here's an out-of-the-box question. Don't the citizens of the U.S. deserve to know what happened in the run-up to the war and to 9/11 and for free? Tenet may feel as he claims damn lousy about the screwed-up national intelligence estimate that helped pave the way to the war in Iraq, but he didn't feel bad enough to resign or to disclose earlier what had gone wrong. He sat on the story, and now he's peddling it for personal profit, to which I would say...
Absolutely correct, sir.
Tenet should have long ago been questioned openly by a congressional committee about all of this, though no Republican committee chair would have dared or should have spilled all to 60 Minutes and other media as a public service, not as an ad for his book. On Friday, Representative Henry Waxman, chairman of the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee, sent Tenet a letter asking him to testify before his committee on May 10th regarding one of the claims used to justify the war in Iraq, the assertion that Iraq sought to import uranium from Niger and related issues. Let's hope Tenet can take time from the book tour to appear. Tenet's a smart guy who saw much, and he was screwed by the White House, even though he did fail to make sure the intelligence on Iraq was properly vetted and responsibly used. But if Tenet indeed believed before the invasion of Iraq that Bush and Cheney were pushing the nation to war without adequately assessing the threat or assessing options other than a full-scale war, he had an obligation at the time to make that known, at least to members of Congress, if not the public at large. He didn't do so. Consequently, he owes the public a full accounting and an apology, not a sales campaign. That's what David Korn says. And you know what? That Korn sure is...
Special?
Special. 1,227 votes. Now, there's a movie that the whole family can enjoy.
Deliverance? Sure.
Deliverance.
Take the kids.
Take the kids along. Deliverance, man. See what it's, see what life is like up there in the woods in Antrim.
Me?
Oh. If you want to see what the rural U.S. is all about, which is about 70% of the country, you just take a look at Deliverance. Poor Ned Beatty, man. I mean, I know, isn't he Irish? He's probably an Irish guy. You know, Irish guys generally have red cheeks, partly because they drink a lot, like Disney. Hey, Disney, have another one, Mike. Boy, now, there was a guy, wow. I mean, as volatile as an H-bomb. Mike Disney, your buddy. Now, were you on my show under his tutelage?
Yes, I was.
Wow. I feel so bad for you.
I got over it.
I think that's where your whole career and your whole life started going downhill, Mike, didn't
No,
it?
Coming to Florida.
Is that what it was?
That's what it was.
I think my life turned around getting out of Florida.
See? It'll do wonders for you.
Yeah.
And when I get out...
How come I can't find that drop where it says...
That's my opinion. I'm Mike Disney.
Oh, I just did? 1229 on there. Like I said, I think we might count these one side by each, one apiece. 1234. Oh, they're coming in chunks for you now, man. I think Chris has got some of his goons working on the streets on this. Everybody get inside and get on a computer and vote for Chris. See, the poll topic is so bad that it's not you're not really voting on the poll question because it blows. It's pathetic. You're voting for Chris to keep his job. You know, when you're working for 50 cents an hour and every day you have to go through this kind of stress, it's not 1, 2, 3, 4, man. Remember that song by Lynn Berry? 1, 2, 3, 4.
No.
1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, I bet you got that in there. You don't have 1, 2, 3 by Lynn Berry? Are you
I'm
kidding
looking.
Me?
Is that Berry with an A or an E?
With an A. A?
Well, then no.
You don't got it?
No, but I'll find
one,
it.
1, 2, 3. Woe is me. 4. 1234. I always like when we get to 1234. I don't know why. It just looks neat on there. Just looks neat on my monitor. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now it's 1, 2, 3, 5. See, it doesn't look nearly as, I don't know, as spiffy. So let's do that math again. We need 65 votes in 50 minutes. Easy. No problem. WQAM, hello.
I think WQAM should bring back the Crow. What do you think?
I think, like the Crow, you stink. WQAM, hello.
Who is it, Barry?
Yeah.
Who it is?
Who that?
Who there?
Who to think it?
Why, who care?
Oh, wow, I thought O.J. had his fill on the air yesterday morning. Now, he's not going to be a regular there on our morning show. And by the way, our morning show is spelled with a U. Like Alonzo, you know, like Alonzo Morning, spelled with a U.
I get
What's
it.
Wrong with that?
That sounds like a shot.
It is. What do you mean it sounds like a shot? It sounds like a shot. It is a shot. You know what I mean? Like that. It sounds like a shot. And guess what? It is.
The Big Rogers. God.
And now, a song from Alec Baldwin's 11-year-old daughter, Ireland.
You are a rude, thoughtless little pig. You made me feel like a fool over and over and over again.
But when he lived with us, before I knew what a psycho he was, my father... Play with his wiggly double chin. I'd hear him yell as I fell asleep. He'd be throwing plates as I counted sheep. And I knew for sure he was not. I just can't get away from him when I go to swim. Just got screamed at by my father again.
You have humiliated me for the last time. I don't give a damn that you're 12 years old, or that you're a child, or that your mother is a thoughtless pain in the... You are a rude little pig.
When Mommy and I left that crazy fool, after he called me a piggy by the pool, he made me cry just to till he got red in the ears, like a bulldog eating mayonnaise. One of his psychotic displays, always dreamed he'd leave us both alone. He doesn't even know my age, has so much.
118. So Matt Damon was in Crash, huh? And I think Alec Baldwin was in there, too. Wasn't he? And Milton Berle and Heine Manouche and Subi Sales. 1250, Chris. You got 42 minutes for 50 votes. Boy, you ought to be able to do that.
We got it.
Speaking of, we got it.
I told you. 1,
that's
2,
right.
3,
I went,
4,
got
5,
it.
6.
1, 2, 3.
Where'd you find that?
I have
Vase. Oh, by Hook or by Crook. I know. You got Vase.
Crook.
Well, see, I told you that was 1, 2, 3, 4. Max Blumenthal writes on the Smirking Chimp. Also posted at the Huffington Post, it says, anybody care about that?
No.
I just know. The contrarian delusion, how Hitchens poisons everything. Christopher Hitchens has made a career out of offending polite society. Among his greatest hits are his observation that women aren't funny, his poo-pooing of the Haditha massacre, and his defense of the jailed Holocaust denier David Irving, who he hailed as a great historian. More recently, Hitchens has volunteered himself as the licker of Wolfowitz's comb, claiming that the corrupt World Bank president did nothing wrong. Hitchens has cast these seemingly untenable positions as contrarian, lending himself not only an air of intellectual bravado, but a veneer of integrity as well. Despite his myriad personal flaws and political contradictions, Hitchens has managed to appear principled by trafficking in opinions that consistently outrage conservatives and liberals alike. He poses as a maverick, an intellectually macho literary gunslinger, who loves nothing more than provoking the indignant howls of the madding crowd. For Hitchens, everything is sacred, and therefore everything is fair game. Those who have followed the trajectory of Hitchens' career knew it was only a matter of time before he set his sights on religion. What better way to piss off the masses than to unleash a full frontal assault on God himself? So to great fanfare and perhaps nobody's surprise, Hitchens has produced God is Not Great, How Religions Poison Everything, an atheist manifesto intended to supplement Richard Dawkins' The God Delusion and New Age torture fanatic Sam Harris's The End of Faith. Hitchens spares no sacred cows in his latest work. He blasts religion as a form of child abuse, claims Jesus Christ never lived, and declares that those who give their children bar mitzvahs are planning your and my destruction and the destruction of all hard-won human attainments. The requisite attacks on Islam, so satisfying to his newfound neocon pals, are also featured at length. Hitchens' book might be mean-spirited, even bigoted, little more than a barely legible screed larded with predictable arguments and a scattershot of pretentious literary references, but who can say that its author is unprincipled? This is contrarianism, right? Please. God is Not Great represents little more than the disingenuous posturing of a certified fraudmeister who is openly cavorted with the most reactionary elements of the Christian right. If Hitchens had any principles at all, if he truly feared the cultural and political consequences of the encroachment of religion into public life, he would have used his still considerable influence to support organizations and causes that shore up the wall between church and state and which defend the rights of non-believers. Instead, Hitchens has done exactly the opposite. In the fall of 2005, Hitchens gladly accepted the invitation of the Family Research Council to speak before its Witherspoon Fellows. Hitchens subsequently regaled an audience of young Christian right cadres with excerpts from his book, Thomas Jefferson, Author of America. For attending Hitchens' lecture and participating in several similar events, the FRC's Witherspoon Fellows received academic credit for study at Pat Robertson's Regent University, a school that has placed 150 of its graduates in Bush administration posts. Presumably, Hitchens was aware of the mission of the James Dobson-founded Family Research Council. How could such an intellectual giant be unaware of the FRC's charge to promote the Judeo-Christian worldview as the basis for a just, free, and stable society? How could Hitchens have missed the FRC's many Justice Sunday rallies staged at megachurches and telecast across America to advance the confirmation of George W. Bush's most theocracy-minded judicial picks? To my knowledge, these rallies occurred well after happy hour, he says. And how could Hitchens have been ignorant of the FRC's vitriolic crusade to ban abortion and undermine gay rights? Regarding FRC President Tony Perkins' ties to white supremacists, I would like to paraphrase scripture and say, forgive Hitchens, for he knows now what the hell he's doing. My well-publicized report detailing how Perkins once purchased the phone bank list of former Klan leader David Duke for the price of $82,500, and how he headlined a 2001 fundraiser for the White Supremacist Council of Conservative Citizens, had only been out for a few months. Maybe Hitchens was too busy dancing with Wolfowitz to read it. But there's no excuse for Hitchens' hypocrisy. With the release of God is Not Great, Hitchens owes his readers an explanation for his appearance at the Family Research Council, the nerve center of a theocratic movement determined to weaken the foundations of constitutional democracy. Hitchens must explain why he accepted the FRC's invitation to speak and whether he was paid for his appearance. While awaiting Hitchens' response, I'll pray that in the future his version of the Straight Talk Express designates a driver.
Cute.
One of the most unctuous subhuman slime balls, Ducci bags, Christopher Hitchens.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's hitching up his pantaloonies right now and getting ready to walk with the devil again. 1,252 votes. What are you thinking? What are you planning? 1,255. 45 votes needed, 37 minutes. Should be a slam dunk. Uh-oh. Don't be using that slam dunk crap. Brings back a lot of bad memories. George Tenet, Your Mind in the Heat. Yeah. Slam dunk sounds like the NBA to me. Bad memories, right, Chris?
Okay.
Of a playoff season gone wrong. How did the Raptors do, by the way? They get eliminated by New Jersey?
Not yet.
They're on the verge?
Let me double check, actually. I know Dallas, the number one
team. I don't care about Dallas. I don't care about the NBA. I'm just asking about my Toronto Raptors.
Okay, I'm looking it up now.
Which I could care less also about. You know, just because they're in Toronto, I mean, who cares about the NBA and a bunch of seven-foot freaks? It's freak ball. It ain't basketball. It's freak ball.
Nets lead the series 3-1, and they play tonight.
They're what?
The Nets are up 3-1.
So the Raptors will be eliminated tonight. Where's that game? In New Jersey, I hope.
No, it's in Toronto. You should go.
Oh, it's in Toronto tonight?
Yeah.
Oh, woe is us.
You should go see Jason Kidd.
You notice how I said us? And you can hear the crowd yelling, go, Raptors, go, up and down the court. No, you can't. They don't. They have no chant. They have no cheer. They have no nothing. They have no history.
Scored 20% of his goals in the playoffs.
There's Esa Tikkanen, one of the great figure skaters in hockey history.
Big, too strong, and unless you take a penalty right here, all you can do is go back to center and face off. And it all started behind the net with a Thornton and Lidstrom battle that ended up with a Thornton win. He kept the puck alive.
Now, let's get hockey intensive here. That should really boost it up. And then when Rimmer comes back from his quadruple bypass, we can have him set up a hockey show, George.
Oh, boy.
You ought to be shot for letting me do that.
I'm sorry. I thought it was a good idea at the time.
But the food was sure good, though. All that free food they used to come
out.
In fact, you know something? This is, I hate to say it because I hope he's okay and I spoke to him yesterday, but there's payback for you, Rimmer. Chopping up all that free food, all that heavy, greasy food, all those pizzas, that's right. All those heavy-duty steaks at Ruth Chris at my great expense. Man. 1,259 votes on the poll. We need 41 mo in 34 minutes, and Chris has got a big smile on his face. He thinks he's got it made in the shade.
Get back to Kenny and Bo. Kelly's joining us again today.
I can't believe Virginia Tech canceled football training.
That's not right.
I'll tell you what's not right. After 9/11, all sports was canceled for almost a week. I was in withdrawal.
Hey, you were doing a show the morning of 9/11, right?
Yeah.
Well, how'd you handle that?
I'm proud to say we kept right on talking about the Miami Hurricane.
I don't know, Gildy. Something like that happens, I might have to put sports aside for a little bit.
That's why you're not going to last as long as I have.
Dude, people were jumping to their death. Our shores were attacked, man. That wasn't a good situation.
What?
So, let me get this right. There's nothing more important in life than sports, right?
I don't care if my house was burning down with my family trapped inside. Nothing will lift my head from the sports page. You want job security at QAM? It's sports, sports, sports. If you want to work here, sports.
Hey, Geldy, come here. Come here. I want to show you something.
Huh?
1:32 at QM. We got Mad Dog coming up at 2 o'clock. Hank from Louisville today, getting ready for the Derby, for the Big Kentucky Derby. 1,264, and we're stuck there. Chris, I'm trying to push that number along. You need only 36 more to get to 1,300, but you've only got 28 minutes. Should be able to do that easy, but I keep hitting that thing and hitting that thing. And 1,266, there's a pair for you. Chris got a pair. We don't want anybody to see him, but nevertheless, 1,266. I think you can do it.
We got it.
Boy, you are foolish, man. Young and foolish. Just like I am. Wait till you see what's going to happen now this last half hour when we take a major hit on the phone here. You watch. We're going to take 80 million phone calls real fast. 5670560, #560 in the Verizon and Singular wireless line. You'll see. In fact, you'll get $5 for every call we take. How would that be? Would you screen the calls if we paid you by the call?
Would I screen them, or I'd put those bad boys
up
there?
It's just a joke. Yeah. WQAM, hello.
How are you enjoying the hockey series, Buffalo Rangers?
How am I enjoying it?
Yes, that's a pretty good series.
I'd enjoy it a lot better if it was 3-0.
Yeah, I agree. Listen, that one question, Woodbine, right?
Yeah. Is that a question?
No, the answer I'm going to give you, I'm going to answer my own question.
Oh, okay.
Okay, get ready. The inside post at Woodbine has a big advantage over the outside post.
I don't play horses at Woodbine, so I could give a crap less.
Oh, okay, you play Pompano, eh?
I beg your pardon?
Eh? You play Pompano?
Eh?
Let me say it again. I don't play the horses these days, okay, sir? I don't play Pompano. I don't play Gulfstream. I don't play Woodbine. I don't play Narragansett Park. I don't play Suffolk Downs. I don't play Rockingham. I don't play Finger Lakes and Canandaigua. No. Call up the Humper and tell him the rail's got the big advantage over the outside. Oh, my God. Like, that's something new. And I don't even know if he's talking about harness racing or thoroughbreds. And I'm sure neither is he. Let me ask you something, and then the question was Woodbine, and he's going to answer his own question. Wow. WQAM, hello.
Hey, how's it going?
Great.
Hey, I heard you're up in broadcasting in Toronto.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about the band Rush?
Yeah, I sure do. I like Rush.
Yeah, they're pretty good. They got a new CD coming out. I thought I'd let you
know. I like Rush. I don't like the guy in the air Rush, but that's a different Rush.
Yeah, he kind of sucks. But anyway, take it easy. Thanks.
Okay, see you. Yeah. That's what I would think of when I would think of Toronto is Rush, wouldn't you? Immediately, I get a Rush thinking about it.
All the time.
1272 on the pool, Chris. Keep your eye on it. 26 minutes, we need 28 votes. That's just barely more than 1 minute. If you can't do that, man, you ain't squat. WQAM, hello. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I love when George is in the background going, it's Reverend Joe. It's Reverend
Joe. Yeah, okay, good. WQAM is his boyfriend. QAM, hello.
Hey, Neil. How you doing?
Yes. Good.
Yeah,
how you doing?
I'm just hanging out scratching tickets. I just won $100.
$5670560, #560 on the Verizon Singular Wireless line. He just won $100. That ought to change his life, wouldn't you think? I guess you don't have to eat out of dumpsters tonight. WQAM, hello.
Hey, how you doing, Neil?
Oh, okay, sir, how you doing?
Real good. I was reading in Reader's Digest on a throne the other day that there's three foods, brown rice, broccoli, and sweet potatoes or yams, whatever you call them, actually takes more energy to digest. You actually lose weight by eating those three foods. I know we can't live off of those three foods, but it's pretty interesting.
You know what I'm going to get right after the show today at 2 o'clock? I'm getting me some ice cream. Boy.
I think he disheartened
me. He took offense at that. He didn't say, don't do it. You're going to croak. Your blood sugar is going to go soaring up there. He didn't do that. And even you didn't do that. You didn't say, because you gave up. You know, you gave up on fat people, including me, a long time ago. I'm just in the mood. Remember that song, I'm in the mood for love? Well, I'm in the mood for ice cream.
All right.
And you want to know why? There's a connection because I love ice cream.
Yeah. There's nothing you can do. It's like talking people out of heroin. You just don't do it.
If anybody thinks that heroin, you know, if there's a stronger drug than sugar, if there's a more addictive substance than sugar, heroin, I'm you know, probably ain't even in the same league. Ask, what's his name there, Eric? Ask Jared Leto. He's in haze with that purple arm. Boy, that's a nasty scene there. Now, there is a movie, Requiem. Pretty soon they'll be calling and saying, oh, that movie sucks too, Neil. Crash was bad, but Requiem for a Dream was really bad. Although, that's not a movie a lot of people talk about. You know? There's a movie, I guess, Ricky already saw that. I think the theme, though, is more appropriate.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of sets the tone.
Right.
It's a little on the depressing side, okay? I'm going to be on television, Sarah Goldfarb. She's going to be on television. Not. I think there's a message in that movie, too. It's very subtle that drugs are bad. Very subtle message, not. 1281 on the poll, Chris. 19 votes needed, 23 minutes. It is a slam dunk, as George Tenet and what's his name would say.
82.
82 what?
1282.
Trombones. Oh, now you're checking one at a time? You're so insecure?
1283.
Guess what? I got 1283. Nah, 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 nah. I got 1283. Your mama. So we need only 17 votes.
Exactly. See, I told you.
22 minutes. You know, you're talking like you had something to do with this, like it wasn't the old legendary queen himself that pushed this up to 1,300 just to try to save your pathetic 47.
Oh, give him something,
job.
Will you?
What?
Well, you're so kind.
See, there he goes kissing my ass again. That one guy that called earlier, that was just, I feel unclean after that call. Remember the guy, that old guy that kissing my ass about, I don't even know what he was talking about.
Neither, I ignored it.
And neither did he. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil, what's going on?
Yes, sir.
Hey, there is no addiction to sugar. You just have to think before you eat.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. Schmuck. There's no addiction to sugar, right? There's no addiction to drugs either. You have to think before you inject, before you snort. Putz. Real putz. There's no addiction to sugar. There's another pseudo-intellectual who just makes an asinine statement and then, like, you know, he's sucking on his lollipops or whatever he's doing there, on his working his popsicles, and that's it. That's the end of that. And you know something? Probably skinny as a rail. He's probably one of those skinny people, you know? I hate those people. Real skinny, Skinny Atlas. Do you know there's such a place? Did you ever hear such a place, Skinny Atlas, New York?
No.
You never heard of that?
No.
It's pronounced.
Yeah.
It's spelled, I don't know how it's spelled. It's spelled S-K-A-N-E-A, you know, scan it. But it's pronounced Skinny Atlas.
How do you like that?
I don't know. It's somewhere. It's not one of those horseball towns in upstate New York, you know. Like Geneva, Canandaigua, Penyan, Fredonia, Dunkirk. You've heard them all.
Sure.
1285. We need only 15 votes to save Chris's 4 cent an hour job.
Lollipop, little boy.
Bum 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 bran. Bum 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 bran. Anyway, I think Iran is a great threat. The Iranians are continuing their efforts to acquire a nuclear weapon. Bum 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 bran. Bum, 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 Iran. And that old Beach Boys song, Bum, Bum, Iran.
Good morning, Americans. It's Paul Harvey. Stand by for news. Abigail McGillin, an elderly woman, answered a knock at the door one day only to be confronted by a well-dressed young man carrying a vacuum cleaner. I'll say it again. The young man was carrying a vacuum cleaner. Good morning, said the man. If I could take a couple of moments of your time, I'd like to demonstrate the very latest in high-powered vacuum cleaners. Go away, said Abigail. I haven't got any money. And she proceeded to close the door. Quick as a flash, the young man wedged his foot in the door and pushed it wide open. Don't be too hasty, he said to Abigail. Not until you have at least seen my demonstration. With that, he emptied a bucket of horse manure onto her hallway carpet. If this vacuum cleaner does not remove all traces of horse manure from your carpet, madam, I will personally eat the remainder. Abigail stepped back and chuckled and said, well, I hope you've got a damn good appetite because they cut off my electricity this morning. Paul Harvey.
Good day.
Good day.
1294 is what you got, Chris. Wow. Not even close. Not even a, you never know. They might slow it down just to aggravate you. Not that the audience would be aggravating. 1295. See, they're trickling in by the ones now. They don't want to have like a big explosion on there because that would be like a letdown, like putting a pinprick in a balloon.
A what?
That's what Duff said.
What word did you say?
Pin in a balloon.
Oh.
1295. That's exactly what I said. 1295. But we're kind of stuck there, Chris. See,
I guess I better call Eric.
Yeah, you better call Eric and tell him to get his thumb off of that switch. Swish. I feel like when you're driving a car, you know, and you slam on the brake. That's what I feel he does to us sometimes. You know? You're going along, you got all the big mo going, big momentum, and then all of a sudden, I don't know, 1295. I keep hitting that view current thing, and it keeps bouncing a little bit, and I come back up, and it still says 1295. We need only 5 votes in 13 minutes to save Chris's job. Maybe Eric hasn't screwed it up. Maybe Josh Cordes is sitting back there in his orifice. Maybe he's got his foot on the brake.
Maybe he's trying to come back.
He wants to make a comeback. See, he can handle the QAM website.
Oh, 1296.
What is it? And you know something? I never look at that thing, even though I'm sure that Josh is doing a fine job on there because he's a good guy and a hard worker and whatever else. I got a nice girlfriend. But anyway, I looked at that last night to see if they had actually done a poll there on the Brady Quinn thing. Remember we discussed that and we said if anybody ought to be doing the poll, it shouldn't be us. It ought to be on the QAM.com on the sports nerd
That's
part
what
of the
you said.
and they didn't do the poll. They didn't do any poll.
Oh, whatever.
I get to keep my job. Anything about it. What?
I get to keep my job for the day.
How do you know that? 1303. Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Woo! All of a sudden, a big chunk, a big lump.
I'd like to
looked
thank
a lot
the
like
Academy.
Chris, as a matter of fact. Big lump came in there right at the ass end, 1303. Looked like that thing I scraped off that, I chewed off that hot dog. You think I'm making it up, don't you?
No.
It looked like a genital wart.
Yeah. I believe you. It was a growth.
It was a growth on a hot dog.
Probably and growth to look at.
It was very growth. I've seen some growth things in my time, and I'm
I'll
sure
bet.
You have, too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I've been around the world. I've seen some very strange things in my time, some of them unidentifiable. Some of them I thought, like, what exactly is that? I don't want to get close enough to find out. But what is that there, you know? Okay, let me read the result, and then we'll forget that we ever did this poll. I apologize, okay? You know something? The fact we had you'll see Friday when that book comes out, you'll see we're going to have a number.
Yeah.
Yeah, good number. We're going to have a number. There's a prediction to live by, boys and girls. Everybody's going to have a number, okay? Some of the numbers might begin with a...
Oh!
I don't want to say what day part that might be, but some of the numbers are going to begin with a...
Oh!
You know. And then some of the other numbers, like Lynn Berry would be sing, would begin with a 1, a 2, a 3, like Lawrence Welk. 1, a 2, a 3. See, now that you found it, now we're going to get regaled with this over and over again. You've got numbers coming out of every part of your orifice.
1, 2, 3.
1303 on a pool, and Chris's job is safe for another day. Boy, it sure is fun to, like, you know, it's always good to be goal-oriented. You know what I'm saying? Goal-oriented. Set a goal and work like crazy for it. An estimated 900,000 Floridians drive our roads with suspended licenses. Your response? Question mark. My response would be, even though we no longer have the choice on there, I hate this pool. I don't know what forced me to do it. I don't know. 1310 now. Oh, look at the way they came through for you in the end, man, in the ass end. And you want to know who those people are? They're the fat people. Us fat people, we always stick up for each other. Isn't that right, Chris? Yes.
Yeah. Does that mean I'm making $131 for this show today?
That means you are still got a job. Confiscate their vehicles, 312. Throw their asses in jail, and maybe the rest of them, too, 258. What do you expect from a third-world driver, 242? Third-world drivers like, you know, Donald Brainerd. I bet most of them are here in South Florida, 199. Just shoot them, 132. Fine them and slap them on the wrist, 58. I'm one of them, 55. And like I said, we're going to track your ass down and Luca Brasi will be pounding on your door along with Xavier Suarez in his bathroom at 3 o'clock in the morning. Whatever happened to him? Did he, like, vanish or something?
Who?
Xavier Suarez.
I don't know.
Your former Miami mayor that used to be knocking on people's doors, canvassing for votes at 2, 3 in the morning in his bathroom.
Miguel hangs out with him.
Well, he had Joe Carroyo disease, you know. Whatever happened to Joe Carroyo when that coffee canister he threw at his wife? And last and least, revoke their license permanently, 54. 1310. Boy, well, it wasn't even close. We still got 10 minutes to go. We could have, you know, who knows what we could have done. Wow, man, I'm exhausted. And you know, I did it all for you, Chris.
You're too kind, sir, too kind.
That's for damn sure. Do I have time to do this? No, I don't. But remember the article I read earlier about who the hell wrote that? Doug Thompson, about $500 million, a billion? In Iraq?
What about it? You got time.
The fight over the latest Iraq spending bill has all but obscured a sobering fact, writes Ron Hutchison in the CommonDreams.org website. The war will soon cost more than $500 billion. That's about 10 times more than the Bush administration anticipated before the war started 4 years ago. And nobody can predict how high the tab will go. The $124 billion spending bill that President Bush plans to veto this week includes about $78 billion for Iraq, with the rest earmarked for the war in Afghanistan, veterans' health care, and other government programs. Congressional Democrats in Bush agree they can't let their dispute over a withdrawal timetable block the latest cash installment for Iraq. Once that political fight is resolved, Congress can focus on the president's request for $116 billion more for the war in the fiscal year that starts September 1. The combined spending request would push the total for Iraq to $564 billion. What could that kind of money buy? And then it goes on. This is where Doug Thompson stole all that stuff from. Remember he had all those stats in there about
a
college education? He stole it all from this story, from McClatchy newspapers. But that's okay. We love Doug Thompson nonetheless, you know. I mean, he's risking his life doing it. They're just sticking a bunch of, you know, numbers in there. Isn't that interesting how we just fell into that?
Amazing.
Like a bucket of stuff? Not as amazing as the fact we wound up with 1,311 votes, not only on a Tuesday. 13-12, not only on a Tuesday, but also in the beginning of the dog days, after Pesach and Easter, when half of the town is vamoosed, man. And believe me, they do. When in doubt, they all bail out. I mean, big time. Oh, let us out of here, please, please, cracker, please. So I think that's, like I said, Friday you're going to see the result of all this. You're going to see a number. Somewhere between...
That's what I'm afraid of, yeah.
And one. Oh, 153 at QAM. And that morning show, boy, talk about...
Oh! It's Dave in Miami Town.
Don't forget to mail that package out, by the way, George. Very important, okay?
What?
You heard me.
Now back to the Kenny and Bo Show on 560 QAM. Your homo headquarters for the speech impaired.
Goldie, dude, we got JJ on the phone.
Okay, but first I want to say hi to my mommy. Hi, mommy. Look, your Satchel is on the radio again. I'm on the radio. La, la,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Me too.
Go ahead, JJ.
Whoa. I got the used up old pickup over here. And all bunches poo.
Okay, JJ, you can go home now. I said go home now.
Yeah.
Coming up, we got special guest Boiny Mac.
Who's he playing for?
Oh, he's not sports related or nothing.
Duh. Then who is he?
Like I said, Blaney Capel will be joining us to discuss the heartbreaker Snorri.
Is it Coppel or Copel, like Ted Copel?
It's Capel, not Coppel. Coppel will be on tomorrow. Whoa, look who we have on the line. It's Poopy Pinball.
Cute.
What time you got?
It's the big hand is on the 12-part top. You know, and the little hand is on the...
What?
Yeah, I think it's time.
Go tell George we're going over.
Come on, man. Tell Neil to lighten up, dude.
Yeah, it's only a few more minutes.
We'll learn his radio situation eventually.
You know, I actually left myself like 15, 20 seconds short on that.
Now what are you going to do?
Huh?
Now what are you going to do?
Don't forget to mail that package.
I won't. Tomorrow.
13:18 on the...
I'm gathering stuff for it, so tomorrow.
I see.
Good stuff.
Whatever. Stick whatever you want in there. Well, within reason. Anyway, 13:18 on the pool, and the good news is for Chris, he keeps his job another day, another $2.75 in the till.
Bye, bye, bye!